third and two situation last week at Memphis. Reaves took to the air, hitting Larry Brodsky for a 26-yard gain up the left sideline. Then on a key third and 10, Reaves threw to wide receiver Spencer Jackson, the speedy one out of Florida, for another big gain. And when the Tampa Bay Bandits smell the goal line, you can count on Gary Anderson getting the football. He's Mr. Dependable, and he scored on this play against Memphis last week. He seldom fails near the goal line, and tonight, he and the rest of the Bandits hope to ride into the sunset in Tampa with yet another victory. The Bandits and Bulls up next on ESPN. Everyone, and a happy Easter weekend to you. Welcome to Tampa Stadium in Tampa, Florida for the Florida State shootout between the Jacksonville Bulls and the Tampa Bay Bandits. Ryan Franco set to kick off for the Jacksonville Bulls. The young man out of Penn State has had a very good year indeed. Place kicking for the Bulls, and back to receive the opening kickoff will be Bruce Vaughn, number 30, and Robbie Futrell. Make that Ricky Williams, number 44, and Bobby Futrell, number 34 for Tampa Bay. We're underway. Franco with a kickoff, looking for Ricky Williams on the right side. Finds him at the two. Ricky Williams, the speedster from Florida State. And he's out over the 30 to the 31-yard line where the Tampa Bay Bandits will put it in gear. For the offense, that man, John Reaves, the quarterback who's thrown for over 300 yards each of the last 2 weeks. In the backfield will be Gary Anderson and Greg Boone. You may see Ricky Williams a lot tonight. Offensive line will be Dan Fike, Chuck Pitcock, Lee North at center for the injured Chris Foote, Nathaniel Newton, Reggie Smith. The tight end is Marvin Harvey. Larry Brodsky will get a start, as will Spencer Jackson at the wide receivers. First and 10 for the Tampa Bay Bandits at their own 31-yard line. Back to throw is Reaves on first down. The Bandits come out gunning, and he finds his man. And that man is Fitzpatrick, number 83. We'll have more on him in a moment. For the Jacksonville Bulls, defensively, front three, Curtis Anderson, Bob Nelson, Keith Bullard. And the linebackers will be Tom Dickel, Terry Beeson, Vaughn Johnson, Mike Edwards. The defensive backs will be Van Jakes, Don Vesselou, Chester G, and Mark Harper. The Tampa Bay Bandits, as you see, they're working against a defensive unit ranked number 13 in the league, come out with virtually no huddle. Offense employed by the Bandits. It goes to Anderson, and Gary Anderson is hauled down for a gain of only a couple of yards by Chester G. A surprise started tonight for Tampa Bay. Wide receiver number 83 is Jim Fitzpatrick. He is a second-year man out of Illinois State. Wide receiver number 83. It'll be third down and five.
The reason for that, they're going with three wideouts, a tight end, and only one running back, which is Gary Anderson. Now Boone is coming in, and Fitzpatrick goes out, so now they have the regular formation.
All right. Larry Brodsky comes out of there, rather Fitzpatrick comes out of there, and Larry Brodsky comes back in. So third and five for Tampa Bay. Ball's at the 36-yard line. One back behind Reaves. Looking over the middle, and it is intercepted by Jacksonville. Coming up with it will be Rodney McMillan. McMillan is down to the 20-yard line. Or make that Derek Batiste, number 28. Batiste stepped in front and made the interception.
Sometimes, you know, Tampa Bay uses the hurry-up offense, but sometimes it can get you into problems. Now, really, this is not the main receiver that you're looking at. That is Marvin Harvey who saw it. But take a look at Batiste. He just plays the ball right in front. Reaves never saw Batiste come in into play. Boone comes down and makes the play downfield, the tackle at the 21-yard line. Reaves never thrown it, never should have thrown that ball.
Jacksonville offense, quarterback is Ed Luther. Running backs are Larry Mason and Mike Rogier. The line is Bob Gruber. He's a good one. Number 75, George Collins, Jay Pennison, J.T. Turner, Roy Simmons. We'll get to the rest in a moment. First and 10 for Jacksonville on the 21-yard line of Tampa Bay. Rogier, the only setback. Remember, he's got the bad hands. They give it to him right away. He'll go inside the 20 to the 18-yard line. Tight end is Mark Keel. Split receivers are Perry Kemp and Alton Alexis. Freddie Norgren made the tackle on Mike Rozier, Paul.
That time they took a page out of Tampa's book. Jacksonville did. They put Larry Mason, the running back, split way out to the outside.
Tampa Bay defense, Mike Butler, Fred Norgren, and Mike Clark. On the front, the linebackers, James Harrell, Al Richardson, Kelly Kirchbaum, Alonzo Johnson. Defensive backs, Alvin Bailey, Marcus Quinn, Bruce Vaughn, and Dwayne Anderson. Second down and eight. Gain of 2 yards up the middle for Rozier. Now he's joined by Mason in the backfield. But the give again is to Rozier. Rozier to his right, gains maybe a yard or so. where he's brought down by a host of Bandits, including linebacker James Harrell. There's Mike Rozier's numbers so far, Paul, having a great second year as a pro, over 500 yards, second in the league coming in.
It makes a difference, doesn't it, when you get with a team that has a pretty good offensive line. Here's Rozier, the handoff. Now, watch, he does have both of his hands taped, just two fingers on each hand, but he holds onto the ball well. Harrell's there for the tackle to pick up about two.
And six. Ball is on the Tampa Bay 17 after the Batiste interception gave Jacksonville great field position. Luther looks for the quick one to the left. Now he's under pressure and down he'll go. Making the tackle for the Tampa Bay Bandits is number 76.
There is no 76 on a roster, folks.
Well, we don't have a name. We'll try and research it for you. This is all one right. of those surprise starters, Paul.
Well, Ed Luther was going to go to the outside, and he had no chance of going to the outside because the linebackers got in the lane, and then 76 and company. I hate to say that. I don't even know who it is, to be honest with you.
All right, Larry. Swider is the holder for Brian Franco, and his field goal attempt from the 32-yard line. It is long enough, and it is no good. It is wide. It is off to the left. So, with 11:20 to go in the first quarter, Tampa Bay and Jacksonville remain. Bandits, after dodging that bullet, ball and Brian Franco's missed field goal attempt, will have it first and 10 at the 25-yard line. You know, you throw an interception, Jacksonville comes away with no points, has to hurt the Bulls.
It really does. I was surprised they ran with two running plays after a turnover in that area. I'd go with a pass, but I'm not coaching.
First and 10 at the 25. That was the line of scrimmage when Franco attempted his field goal. It was no good. Reaves on the play fake and a screen pass to the left to Gary Anderson. That man gets in the open field. He's trouble. First and 10 Bandits at the 38. Don Vesalou, free safety, has to bring him down.
First of all, this should never happen. Now, Tampa Bay throws a screen to Gary Anderson. That's all well and good. But the problem is that there should be someone always on Gary Anderson coming out of the backfield. There's no linebacker with him. That's all it really should be covering at this point. But just take a look. No one is there at that time. Mike Edwards, number 53, gets caught inside by the blocking, but he did have excellent blocking upfield to first down.
All right, first and 10 at the 38-yard line. Backs in the eye, Boone and Anderson. Boone will block for Gary. Anderson over the 40 near the 41-yard line. Where Bob Nelson, nose tackle, along with Curtis Anderson, big left end, comes up to make the tackle. Gain of three on the play. It'll be second down and seven.
It'll be second and seven.
10:08 to go in the first quarter. Anderson leads the USFL in rushing coming into this game with 519 yards.
Now, we talked about Gary Anderson so much in the first game, but he worked on all of his upper body strength, Tom, and that's what's made him a better football player.
He doesn't look like a physical brute out there, Paul, but he can deliver some punishment.
He loved it.
Reaves back to throw. Both backs are out on the pass pattern. Intended for Anderson. It'll fall incomplete. Derek Batiste was in the area along with Don Vesalou. It'll bring up a third down and seven for the Bandits as Lindy and Fadi looks on.
Tommy, what's happening here? Take a look. Now, both backs are going to come out of the backfield. Now, they cross in front of each other, which brings all the linebacker. Batiste is there, but the linebackers are also in the area. Vesalou's there. But what's happening on the other coverages downfield, they're playing man-to-man. So Reaves must go to one of those outside guys.
It'll be third down and seven from the 41-yard line. Gary Anderson, we were commenting about his league-leading rushing stats. He ran for 163 yards in the stadium a couple of weeks ago against the Arizona Outlaws. You can see Tampa Bay, nearly 50% in third down efficiency.
Number one in the league.
That's right. Reaves looking for a receiver down the left sideline. Intercepted again. This time, Mark Harper has it. And Harper's into Bandit territory, and he's knocked back to the 50-yard line. Spencer Jackson brought him down, but again, the Jacksonville Bulls have come up with a turnover. 9:37 to go in the first quarter, and the crowd is stunned.
Here's again, they're throwing, Reaves is throwing into double coverage because the corner, Mark Harper, is coming back. He was supposed to be covering Brodsky. See 82 outside?
Right.
He just leaves him and helps out on Spencer. He makes the interception. That's Boone making the tackle again on an interception. That's two tackles for Boone. He's the leading tackler. Now, let me just say something. The man that was playing defense, number 76, is Mike Morgan. And on our program and everything we had no jersey change. His number usually is 71. Why he is wearing 76, we don't know.
All right, well, now we do know. All right, Mike Morgan is in there, 76. 9:27 to go first quarter. If you're just tuning in, no score, Jacksonville and Tampa Bay. The Bulls have it, first and 10 at the Bandit 49-yard line after the Bulls picking off their second pass from John Reaves tonight. And Luther comes out and is looking for Alton Alexis on the left sidelines and underthrows Alexis Alonzo Johnson there in the coverage.
Lonzo Johnson was there. There's Reaves. And I hate to say it. I said it in the opening. The first game I did this year was Tampa Bay, Orlando. They won the game handily, no question about that. But Reaves was terrible. And he's starting out tonight basically the way he did it last time. But
not good.
If the defense plays as well as they're playing, and they're capable of playing, because they are, the number two defense in the USFL.
That's right. The Tampa Bay Bandits are the number three defense in the USFL.
They're number four.
All right.
In the USFL.
Second down and 10 for Jacksonville after an incomplete pass. Luther with only Rozier back in the backfield, and he has to let the safety valve go to Mike, and he's got some room. Rozier inside the 40, near the first down marker at the 39-yard line. Marcus Quinn, free safety, comes over to make the hit.
This is going to really pick up the Jacksonville Bulls, because you see his hands are taped right there on Mike Rozier. They didn't know whether they were going to try to throw the ball to him. Now watch, he's going to slip out. He's just a safety valve coming out, and there's no one on him. You've got to put a linebacker on him, because when he gets ahead of steam, he runs right through Marcus Quinn, number 40. No problem there. Picks up about 9.5 yards.
Well, coming in to replace Mike Rozier in the backfield now is Larry Mason. He wears number 32. Also in there is Marvin Lewis. So Mason and Lewis are in there. Rozier leaves at third down and one at the Tampa Bay 39-yard line. Here is the give. It is to Mason. Mason spins away. He's got the first down. Hard running Larry Mason is down to the 30. Third and one now. More importantly for the Jacksonville Bulls, they're worried about getting the first down. They get that and a touchdown. Larry Mason for the touchdown.
Remember the play that Mason ran where he cut back and picked up 6 yards for the first down in the third down situation? Here's the same play again. And they're just handing the ball up and going right at Tampa Bay's defense. There's the handoff to Mason. He cuts right back in the hole. The blocking in the line is absolutely superb. Pennison, number 57, the center, gets a good block. JT Turner, 68, and so did George Collins, 66. Look at the middle open up. See Pennison's block on Kelly Kirchbaum, number 51. When that happens, touchdown Mason.
All right, Brian Franco, who's perfect on extra points this season, lining up to attempt another one. Snap is a good one. The kick is down, and the kick is good. So with 6:49 left in the first quarter from Tampa, the Jacksonville Bulls, a 10-point underdog, have broken out on top. Jacksonville Bulls lead the Tampa Bay Bandits 7-0 as Brian Franco prepares to kick off. Bobby Futrell and Ricky Williams back to receive the kickoff, standing about the 2-yard line. Get more USFL football Monday night. Paul and Jim will be out in Denver for the Gold and the Arizona Outlaws. This kickoff by Franco, 6 yards deep in the end zone. Williams does the right thing. He downs it first and 10, Tampa at their own 20.
All right, remember I said that JT Turner and George Collins got blocked 66 and 68? Watch this. Here's Nordgren there and Mike Morgan right in here. Look at the block in the middle. That's why Mason gets through. They have both linemen on the ground. Here it comes. Then you see the center, Pendison, come out. He blocks on Kelly Kirchbaum. The missed tackle by Mike Clark.
The only thing this is, John Reaves coming out and throwing 2 interceptions on the first 2 possessions of the night. Jacksonville cashing in on the second one for a 7-0 lead. Give is to Anderson, and Anderson is wrapped up for no gain. Keith Millard, the rookie out of Washington State, wraps him up and brings him down.
I mean, Keith Millard, is that Dan Fike that's supposed to be blocking out on him?
Mm-hmm.
Keith Millard just says, forget about it. I'll just go right here and make the tackle in the backfield for a loss of about 0.5 yard.
At Jacksonville scoring drive, Paul, they used up some clock. Well, a little bit of clock anyway. 7 plays, 2 minutes, 48 seconds, 49 yards after the INT. And a 10-yard run. Now they officially make a 10-yard run by Mason for the touchdown. Second down and 10. Reaves looking long over the middle. Got Spencer Jackson, and Jackson has the catch at the 48-yard line of Jacksonville. Chester G was with him, but a beautifully thrown football.
Now, I'm going to tell you, this is a perfect pass and a perfect route. And Chester G, even though he makes the tackle, he does the smart thing. Don't gamble on the interception. He couldn't get there. The pass protection is excellent. Reaves is going down, and he's looking now left at Spencer. He was looking left, and then it goes back right to Spencer. But look where the ball is thrown. Chester G could have made a mistake and go for the football. Wouldn't have had it. It would have been a touchdown, but he saved the touchdown.
Officials mark it right at midfield, so it's first and 10 for the Bandits at their own 50-yard line. Steve Carter and Larry Brunsky now in the game. Both of them are in split formation. Brunsky to the bottom of the screen, Carter to the top, but it's a pitch out to Anderson. Anderson will pick up a couple of yards where Mark Harper brings him down, bring up a second down and 8. They seem content at that time in that play to go over the left tackle Fike and left guard Pitcock.
Well, Fike and Pitcock are two pretty good blockers. I can see them going in there. They don't really have a problem at center. Lee North is in there playing center. Their normal center is not in. He is hurt. and that's Chris Foote, number 62, is going to be out for quite a while.
Gain of two for Gary Anderson. Now Anderson is being put as a slot back. He's actually a receiver to the top of the screen. He's standing right on the 50-yard line. We're told to expect this tonight. And here it is. Reaves, short drop over the middle, and it is intended for Brodsky, but knocked away by Mark Harper. Intended for Brodsky and almost intercepted.
Poor choice, because on the top side, he had Carter, number 11, and Gary Anderson with no one on him.
Well, obviously, he didn't see him.
Here is a block in the offensive line. There's Fike and Pitcock blocking here. There's nothing wrong with that blocking.
Mm-mm. Keith Millard will tell you that.
But the problem is he threw the Reaves threw the ball to Brodsky, and there were four people around Brodsky.
All right, the incompletion brings up a third and eight at the 48-yard line of Jacksonville. First time the Bandits have been in Bulls territory tonight. Plenty of time for Reaves again, going right to the top of the screen to Spencer Jackson, just off his fingertips. Out there covering was Chester G, but if Jackson hangs on to that, he's got a first down.
Oh, yes, he did. That ball was just on the fingertips. Here we go with Fike on Millard. Now, Millard is the number one sacker for Jacksonville. Now they switch off. Pitcock takes him when he goes inside. Almost there. Almost, Keith.
Zenon Andrezicin, the veteran out of UCLA, leading punter in the United States Football League. Back to punt, standing at his 37. He'll get away from his 40-yard line. Double safety back for Jacksonville. Perry Kemp. And this is Gary Clark. Clark calls for the fair catch, and he gets it, but deep in Jacksonville territory at the 9-yard line. 4:22 to go in the first quarter. Our score, Jacksonville 7, Tampa Bay nothing. Back in just a moment. Luther, nobody in the backfield to block for him, so he dumps it off over the middle and complete to Marvin Lewis. Wayne Anderson makes the tackle, but Paul McGuire, Marvin Lewis makes the first down.
Again, I said it in the last series of downs, when the backs are blocking and then come out of the backfield, there's really no one there. Now, Fred Norgren, he's over the center. Now, just take a look. They're double teamed. JT Turner and Pettison are both there blocking on Norgren, and he's also getting some help in the back.
That's a tough day at the office.
Oh, I guess so. You can't get to him. But you see what I'm saying? Look at where all the people are. There's no one. Dwayne Anderson finally comes up and makes the play, but there are no linebackers on the backs.
First and 10 for the Bulls at their own 22-yard line. After that first down completion by Luther. Luther has the pass batted down. Alonzo Johnson from Florida A&M, third-year veteran, just pounds that one back to the turf. It'll be second down and 10.
Ed Luther was looking to Alexis on the outside, and Alexis was wide open because the cornerback, Alvin Bailey, is playing off Alexis about 12 yards. And when you have that much of a cushion, that's a great play, except for one thing. You've got to get it over the linebacker.
Second down and 10. At the 22. Out to the right goes Marvin Lewis. Three wide receivers, but the give flags all over the place. The give is to Rozier. Rozier battles his way over the 25 to the 29-yard line. But there's flags on the field near the line of scrimmage.
And I think Mike Butler got into the neutral zone.
Let's listen to Wesley Ward.
Offsides, number 77 on the defense. Second down.
Exactly right, Mr. McGuire. Mr. Butler was the offending party.
You know, it's very easy to do that, Tom. You know why? Because he's the only guy that moves. And you have to be a dummy not to know that that's the guy.
Well, the penalty being marched off against the Tampa Bay Bandits. The down will remain the same, and the Bulls will gain 5 yards in the play. So instead of second and 10, it'll be second and 5 as Lindy Infante sends a play in with his running back, Larry Mason. He's shuttling. What he's doing is he's shuttling Mason and Marvin Lewis with the plays nearly going to Ed Luther. Lindy, of course, former offensive coordinator with the Cincinnati Bengals. Second down and 5. Again, three wide receivers for Jacksonville. Luther looks left again for Alton Alexis, but again, the ball is underthrown. On the coverage was Alvin Bailey.
You know who does it? Alonzo Johnson, again, number 58. He is getting to the back, and he gets his hands up, and Luther can't see the receiver, and he has to almost throw blind. But here comes Norgren now. Pennison is at the center. Look at this. You got two people on him all the time. Norgren's going to get a little tired of that.
Well, of course, when you have two people on the nose tackle, Mr. Alonzo Johnson must love that because it frees somebody up on that line.
Yeah, if you blitz. If you blitz, that's the only way you can get those two people off of him.
Big play for the Bulls now. Third down and 5. Rozier, the only setback. Luther again looking left all the way, fakes the defense off the man. That is Alton Alexis, and Alexis is over the 40-yard line or the 41-yard line before Alvin Bailey drives him out of bounds, but a big catch there and a Bull first down.
I can't believe that Alton Alexis was that wide open. Here's Luther setting up, and he's looking out there the entire way. Look at, he pumps. He's waiting for him to get open. Now, Alton Alexis, there was a pick on the outside. Take a look at it. Here comes Alexis. He fakes like he's going inside, slips back outside, but watch. It takes about 4 or 5 yards of running before Alvin Bailey gets there. And watch his shot. Bing.
Gets hit by his own teammate. That was Wayne Anderson. Larry Mason now goes out, split receiver to the right. Rozier, the only setback. Luther, being pressured by both ends, dumps it out to Mason, who comes back for it. Mason's got some running room. He's into Bandit territory, and he's got a first down. Dwayne Anderson, or make that the tight end, Mark Keel with the reception. Dwayne Anderson forces Keel down, but not until Keel picks up the first down.
This is a pretty play because it's a screen, but they only put one man out there, and that's Collins is out there. Number 66 gets over. Now you see Dwayne Anderson making a tackle, but that's after Mason already has, or Keel, excuse me, has the first down.
First and 10 at the Tampa Bay Bandit 43-yard line. Jacksonville moving the ball well against one of the better-rated defenses in the United States Football League. Marvin Lewis is in there at a slot back now, split out to the bottom of the screen. Quick one over the middle. I don't know who he was intending a ball for, but Keith Clark almost had an interception for Tampa Bay.
He was trying to throw a little dump pass to Lewis coming out of the backfield right behind the linebacker, but he hit Keith Clark in the hands. Watch it. You'll see Clark reach up and go, but you see 24 coming out underneath. He's trying to throw that little dump pass to him. He was not there. Clark was. Almost a bad mistake. Every mistake is a bad mistake.
Absolutely. Well, Steve Spurrier would agree with you. 58 seconds to go in the first quarter. I'm Tom Meese with Paul McGuire, and that's our score, 7-0, Jacksonville. They've intercepted two John Reaves passes tonight, passed it on one of them. Luther on the delay to Mike Rozier. Rozier trying to get away from the initial tackler, cannot do it as Mike Butler drags him to the turf. Also in there, Keith Clark. Short gain of 2 or 3 yards for Rozier.
You can tell you how strong Mike Butler is because he got one arm on Rozier and pulled him down. And running with your legs has nothing to do with your hands.
Clock running, 30 seconds to go now in the first quarter. Third down and 7 from the 40. Alton Alexis split out wide to the top of your screen. Luther looking left. Also looking long, but now he's thinking about taking off with it. Flag down on the play. Listed for the end zone. He's got a man. That is Clark. Is he inbounds or not?
We'll make a decision down there.
It's touchdown. They say Clark's got it for the touchdown, but keep in mind we have a flag on the play, and it was thrown in the backfield. Nice catch by Gary Clark. A nice throw by Luther, Paul, but let's see if it counts.
Well, they're not too happy because they're all coming back.
Took a while for the official to signal touchdown down there.
Holding. 79 on the offense.
That's A.V. Richards, the man who came in for the injured Roy Simmons at right tackle. And look at Lindy Infante. His face tells it all.
I just can't believe that Clark was so wide open in the end zone. Take a look at once Luther starts running around, everybody just, they left Clark alone. Look, he's waving. Now, all he's got to do, he's thinking, now, just let me catch it. I got to stay in bounds. That's great concentration.
Yep.
Gets in bounds, gets 2 feet in.
But I'm sorry.
If he had four legs, you'd have them all in. You know that?
You think so?
He danced in there twice.
Lindy Infante, 8-16, regular season record coming in. He hopes to improve it tonight. But we reached the end of the first quarter with our score. Jacksonville 7, Tampa Bay nothing. We'll be back for second quarter action at Tampa Stadium. Tampa Bay Sundancers entertaining a very large crowd on this Saturday night in Tampa. It rained all day. A front moved through the area earlier in the day. The rain stopped around 6 o'clock this evening. And fortunately, and we believe it will last for the rest of the night, the rain is gone. Our situation to start the second quarter, Jacksonville with the ball, 3rd and 17. After the holding play that nullified the touchdown at midfield, the Bulls lead it 7-0. Ed Luther has to roam around to his left. He's got a man deep. That's Clark again. Marcus Quinn over there, and Marcus Quinn bats it away. The ball hung up in the air, Paul, and gave Marcus Quinn some time.
It looked like a punt return. I mean, the way Luther, I got a feeling it had to slip out of his hands because he did have Clark deep again. And Marcus Quinn finally got back there, but he had they had time for a linebacker to get back there and make a fair catch. The rush is going to be coming at him, and he's going to spin out to his left. And when he does that, now, does he set up? We'll watch and see if he does. He sets up fine, but I got a feeling that it looked like a javelin throw there. I mean, he got it off the front foot all right.
Well, the leading punter in the USFL gets to swing into action for the first time tonight. Larry Swider also is a holder on place kicks for the Bulls. Tim King and Bruce Vaughn back in double safety. Now it's Vaughn by his lonesome. Swider's punt goes out of bounds inside the 20, inside the 15, at the 12. First and 10 for the Bandits there. Our score, Paul, the common opponents this year, Tampa Bay has beaten Memphis, Arizona, and Orlando, while Jacksonville has defeated Orlando in overtime but lost to Memphis and Arizona.
That was questionable, the Memphis game.
It was.
That's at best.
All right. It is 7-0. And it is first and 10 for Tampa Bay, but after Swider's punt went out of bounds at the 12-yard line, John Reaves starts in a hole. Reaves looking for Marvin Harvey, the tight end, and it is off his hands and incomplete. Coverage over there supplied by Van Jakes.
And he's hurt. Van Jakes, I don't know what he did, but...
...will punt from about his goal line. That's where he'll get it off, and you see Gary Clark and Perry Kemp standing at the 40-yard line of Jacksonville. The Bulls, if everything goes their way, should come out of this with excellent field position. 14:30 left in the first half. Tampa Bay's offense really has shown nothing of consistency at all tonight. In position, a low kick. This one is returnable. Here's Clark at midfield. Gary Clark is dragged down after a 9-yard return at the 36-yard line. Actually, that's a 14-yard return. So Jacksonville will have it first and 10. All right, first and 10 for Jacksonville. They have it after the punt return at the 37-yard line. That's the official marking of the Tampa Bay 37. Here goes Mike Rozier, and there goes the football. It's loose, and Tampa Bay has recovered. We have a flag on the play. Rozier fumbled, and the Bandits recover. Marcus Quinn finally picked up the loose football. And a Bandit is kneeling over injured at about the 37-yard line.
But there is a penalty.
Referee Wesley Ward trying to sort it out for us.
They refuse it. It's against Jacksonville.
Formation on the offense declined. First down.
So the fumble recovery will stand, and that man, Marcus Quinn, has given the Bandits the football.
Well, he's mad. He's talking to his players. Here comes Rozier now. Do they grab his hands? He's got one hand on the ball. That's Kelly Kirchbaum, number 51. It makes the initial hit that pulls the ball away. Alonzo Johnson knocks it away, and then Marcus Quinn picks it up. But Kelly Kirchbaum, being blocked, got his arm in and just pulled his hands away. And that's the man that's hurt.
Kelly Kirchbaum, who's one of the most active linebackers in the league, veteran out of the University of Kentucky. And so it'll give Tampa Bay the football at their own 32.
I'm just guessing, but, you know, when you see him hold his arm like that, could it be a hyperextension? We don't know if it's in the hand or wrist, but he was being blocked, and he reached his arm and just pulled the ball away.
First turnover of the night for the Jacksonville Bulls. We'll see if the Tampa Bay Bandits will make it a costly one or not. Reaves back to throw. Dumps it out to Gary Anderson. Anderson's got some blocking, and Anderson is up to the 37, 38-yard line. Van Jakes helping to make the tackle.
All right, we're going to take a look at Kelly Kirchbaum again, and maybe we can hold it there when he sticks his arm in. Now, take a look at Kirchbaum. There's going to be a block on him by George. Is that George Collins, 66? Now, watch his right arm. He's going to reach in right here and pull the ball out, but this is, I think, where it's hyperextended, right there. Good play by Kelly.
Gain of 6 yards by Gary Anderson. On that last play, second down and 4 for the Bandits at the 38. They trail the Jacksonville Bulls 7-0 if you're just tuning in. Here's that man again, Gary Anderson, and Anderson, second effort over the 45-yard line for the first down. Don Besselou with a tackle.
Well, a continuous effort of Gary Anderson. Remember, the last series of downs, he didn't touch the ball. This time, 2 times in a row. Boone's out in front blocking, but watch, there's no hole there at all. Now watch what he does. He just keeps his legs driving. Besselou comes up, makes a block on him, hit the knees, but he picks up 7 or 8 yards.
I'm telling you, Gary Anderson showed some power, and I apologize for saying second effort. There is no such thing, I know.
That's right.
It's continuous effort.
All if right. It's second effort, that means he quit the first time.
First time.
Remember that.
I will, from now on. Believe me, first and 10 at the 46 for the Bandits. Max Boone and Anderson both in tight. Now they both go out in the pass pattern. Carter is his intended receiver. A flag on the play, and we could have some pass interference against Van Jakes. In fact, I think that's almost certainly what it is.
Well, The thing that you can call is because, first of all, the ball, I don't know if he could get to the ball or not on Carter, but Van Jakes runs into him as he makes his move upfield. Now, let's take a look at it. Here comes Carter downfield. Van Jakes, number 22, is going to cover. Now, Carter moves to the outside. When he does that, he's got to have a right to get to the ball. And Van Jakes did not give him that right to go for the ball. He got in his way, and it's a call. Excellent call by the official. It's a 15-yard penalty.
From the line of scrimmage. It is not the point of the foul unless it's ruled to be deliberate, and that was not. First down at the 22-yard line. Bandits with their first legitimate threat of the night. Anderson goes left. Gary Anderson brought down for a loss. A beautiful play by Mark Clark, the right cornerback. You talk about forcing the run. I'm sorry, Mark Harper. Mark Harper, the right cornerback. He really forced the run. In fact, he forced a 3-yard loss. He wasn't fooled that time.
All right, Mark Clark is the man that makes the play. Here comes Jackson in motion. Now, he is supposed to block, and that is Mark Harper. He's supposed to block, does not block him, and Harper makes a great play into the backfield, gets Gary Anderson. Did I say Clark, too?
Yes.
It's
catching.
Don't say that.
I'm sorry. It must be catching. Second down and 13.
He was the commandant of the Citadel when I was here.
You're kidding.
General Mark Clark, you bet.
He never forgot you. I'll bet you that. Anderson out of the backfield, and Reeves looking for him, overthrows Anderson at about the 25-yard line. Don Besselou was there.
I would run the same play again and then go down to Marvin Harvey, number 87, right down the middle of the tight end, because Besselou made a mistake. They're all worried about Gary Anderson coming out of the backfield. You have to send him out, hold the linebackers, the tight end will be open. But here they come. They have a blitz on this time. Gary Anderson slips out. You see Tom Dinkle coming in. He's got pressure on him. The ball was overthrown. I'd run the same play right there, same thing, and look at the big tight end going right down the middle of the field.
Third down and 13. Ball at the Jacksonville 25. Bandits trail 7-0. Reeves got some time. Stays in the pocket. He's got the first down. That is the Larry Brutsky. Touchdown, Tampa Bay.
When Brusky makes this catch, the move that he puts on Mark Harper is absolutely beautiful. It's got to go in the highlight film and to teach any young man what to do after you catch the football. Because Brusky, he does not have great speed, but he's got excellent hands and tremendous moves. And he puts a move on after he catches the football that leaves Mark Harper standing there saying, what happened?
Where'd he go?
He's gone. Touchdown.
All right. The touchdown pass from Reeves to Larry Brodsky, who caught a TD pass last week against the Memphis Showboats. Makes it 7-6. Zenon Anderson out of Jimmy Jordan's hold. He's perfect on the air at extra points, and he remains so. So the Bandit fans have something to cheer about. Call out the law. Tampa Bay has tied it up at 7. 10:30 to go in the first half. Brodsky, the touchdown receptor. We're tied at 7. And Zenon Anderson moves into the kickoff. At the 10-yard line, make it the 12, is Perry Kemp. Kemp over the 25 near the 30-yard line, a short kickoff, and so the Bulls will have excellent field position.
All right, now I told you about Brodsky on Mark Harper, the move he makes. Here it is. You're going to see the wide-open field. Reeves just sets his ball right into Brodsky, but watch this here. He makes a move to his left. There goes Harper, bang, on the ground. Look at Harper can't. Forget that. Batiste comes in. Dabrowski just takes him into the end zone. And you think this man is not happy? Take a look at that. He'll tell you it's a touchdown.
Mm-hmm.
No flags.
The looks in John Reeves' eyes, the intensity. He wanted that one in a hurry. He's had a rough night so far tonight. His first two possessions, he threw interceptions. But we're all tied up at 7 with 10:07 to go in the first half. First and 10 at the 29 for the Bulls. Luther. And he's got his man this time. That's Alton Alexis. First down up at the 45-yard line. Alonzo Johnson makes sure that Alexis doesn't advance the football. So Ed Luther comes out firing, and a nice play as Steve Spurrier wonders what went wrong with his defense that time.
Well, Alvin Bailey is staying off. He's lining up about 9 yards off Alton Alexis, and then he's dropping off as he comes off the area. And he's going to get some help underneath. He's got to play him a little bit closer.
Mike Morgan, number 76, who had a big play early in the game, coming in at linebacker now for Tampa Bay. First and 10 for the Bulls at their own 45. Luther straight back to throw. Over the middle, this one is complete as well to Robert Young. Robert Young is into Tampa Bay territory near the 45-yard line and near the first down.
Well, this time the tight end. Now, here we go. Luther Ed Luther's going back, setting up. He's looking right over the middle for the tight end. He breaks away. Tight end is wide open. The other man, Mark Keel, the other tight end, came across. They cross in the middle. No linebackers there. Finally, a tackle is made.
Kevin McClellan makes the tackle just short of the first down. It'll be second down and one. Mason, running back, is split now as a wide receiver to the top of the screen. Give us to Mike Rozier. Rozier doesn't have much, but he didn't need much. I believe he's got the first down. Walter Carter makes the initial hit for Tampa Bay.
That's first down. Mike Morgan was also in there, number 76. I'll never forget that number now.
They slipped him in under our noses.
Yeah.
Early in the ball game. First and 10 at the 44-yard line. Freddie Norgren comes off the bench now. He comes in replacing Mike Morgan. So Norgren, who has 7 sacks on the season, is in at nose tackle for the Bandits. He's really the only setback. Luther, under pressure, has to unload it, and he just, I think, threw that ball away to escape the grasp of Alonzo Johnson, who put him down to the turf rather rudely.
See, that? There, here's the problem now. When you see a full-scale blitz and you only have one back in the backfield, at that time it was Mike Rozier, because they had the full-scale blitz on, there was nobody to come from Luther's backside. He never saw Alonzo Johnson. The receivers are running. They know they're one-on-one coverage, so they're running quick ins. And Luther just threw the ball outside.
Second down at 10 now at the 44-yard line. Luther in a long count. Looks over the middle. It is complete. Larry Mason makes that tight end Mark Keel. Mark Keel comes down with it. Short of the first down. Pick up a 5 or 6 yards. James Harrell makes the stop. Mark Keel, a big man, 6'4", 227, out of Arizona, his third year.
Look at Alton Alexis now on Alvin Bailey. Here he comes out. Now Alvin Bailey knows he's got help deep, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's the help, back by King, number 38. So he hits, chucks the wide receiver, and then moves to the outside. He's got everything shortened to the outside.
Well,
except
there's
going to tight end. Sorry.
That's okay. Third down and two after reception by Keel. Ball at the 36-yard line. And the give to the 35-yard line goes Larry Mason, and he is short of the first down. I'm almost absolutely sure he was stopped before the first down.
There's no question about it. They're about 6 inches short here.
Kevin McClellan being credited with that tackle, number 57. And it is fourth down. An interesting decision now for Lindy Infante. Has the ball to 35.
No decision. Here comes number 30.
Yep, Mike Rozier. And back in for Tampa Bay comes Mike Morgan. He'll replace Ron Simmons, who was in there for a play or two.
A man you saw writing on a chalkboard with Buck Ballou.
Buck Ballou, former All-American at Georgia and starting quarterback earlier in the year at Jacksonville. They've had a lot of those. Fourth and inches. The give is to Rozier. He may or may not have had it. The Bandits say he was stopped. Fred Norgren made the first hit. We'll have to wait and see, but the Bandit offensive unit is coming on the field.
I'll tell you, Freddie Norgren was in the backfield, and he hit Rozier 2 yards deep in the backfield. What a great play by the nose man. Watch right over the center. Norgren goes through the hole, comes up. He has to come up to hit Rozier. He does that, gets Rozier going straight up in the air and the rest of the defense. Now watch, you'll see Norgren. Not only does he get through, but look at, he gets his helmet right in his legs. Rozier can't get off the ground. They stop him. In fact, they lost a half a yard.
So it's first and 10 for the Tampa Bay Bandits as Lindy Infante is asking his offensive unit what went on that time. You should always, I believe, be expected to pick up a first down on fourth and inches. You have a runner, the capabilities of Rozier. First and 10 at the 35. And the give is to Gary Anderson. Anderson has maybe a yard. Bob Nelson, nose tackle, brings him down. 6 minutes to go now in the first half.
You know, if people back out there questioning Lindy Infante, you're at the 35-yard line, you better go. I mean, go now. I think it was an excellent play. I don't know about the call. The blocking wasn't there because they didn't keep Norgren out. But fourth and 6 inches or a little bit less than that, yeah, you've got to go.
Well, it's like a lot of people say. If you're a pro football team, you have a good offensive line, a good runner, fourth and 6 inches, and your field position is decent, you ought to go, and 99% of the time, you ought to make it. However, this 1% of the time, Jacksonville did not. Reeves unloading it to Anderson in the flat. He's always dangerous out there, but he's corralled this time by Vaughn Johnson, second-year man out of North Carolina State. So Anderson has held a gain of 1 or 2 yards.
I'll tell you, Vaughn Johnson, the linebacker, really made a great play because he was actually getting blocked at the time. He just stayed. He did not take the fake of Gary Anderson, stayed with it, and made the tackle.
The excellent crowd here tonight at Tampa Stadium, Paul. Somebody's going to walk out of here with quite a few $1,000s in their pocket.
I got my tickets, pal. You bet.
For every fan over 40,000, for example, if there's 50,000 people here tonight, someone will win $10,000. Someone sitting in a lucky seat. It's all part of a big giveaway night this Easter Eve in Tampa. Reaves on the pass has his first down. Just short of midfield, Larry Brunsky makes the reception. Mark Harper the tackle.
This young man here has got a great attitude. He's laughing because Larry Brodsky knows he's got great moves. Here's the offensive line blocking. There was a blitz on. Vaughn Johnson, 33, a delayed blitz. But the offensive line did a great job. You see he steps up nicely into the pocket. Well, watch Brodsky now. Eyes on the ball. There's Mark Harper is right there with him. Brodsky makes the catch. He's just looking for first down.
First and 10 at midfield. He gets the first down. Brodsky, the third-year man out of the University of Miami. Reaves, back to throw, hits Anderson out of the backfield. Gary is wrapped up after a gain of 3 or 4 yards. Terry Beeson, former Seattle Seahawk in the NFL, former Oklahoma Outlaw, makes the tackle.
But you see, Tom, when I'm talking about Gary Anderson coming out of the backfield, that's a 5-yard play. Every time he comes out, he gets that 4 or 5 yards. Now, if he doesn't make the tackle, Anderson picks up anywhere from 10 to 15. So you have to respect him. That freezes those linebackers, so they can't help on the outside. The outside people have to play man up.
Second down and 5 as Anderson goes out, split as the wide receiver to the right. Lower part of your screen. Reaves looking his way. He's got it. And Anderson steps out of bounds, but not until he has the first down. They mark him down at the 32-yard line. Nobody home on defense.
Well, Van Jakes is smart because he doesn't want to give up the touchdown. Watch Gary Anderson. He just goes down, a little quick out move. That's 10, 12 yards right there. Van Jakes is way off. He comes back in. If Anderson had a little bit more room on the outside, it would have been good night.
I'll tell you, it's something to have an athlete that can catch the ball as well as he can, run in the open field, and has some power.
Very good point, Tom. The thing about it is, with Anderson back there, you can't cover him with one man. You better put two people on him, which is going to tie up a linebacker and a corner or safety.
First and 10 for the Bandits at the Bull 32-yard line. Reeves got it cranked up now, looking for Spencer Jackson. Overthrows him on the coverage over there. It was Chester G out of Duke, but Reeves overthrew his man, and he knows it.
You know, when you put Gary Anderson on that side, on the right-hand side, like they did that last play, then they took Marvin Harvey, the tight end, and ran him out into the flat. Marvin Harvey is wide open because the linebacker and the corner, Van Jakes, are taking Gary Anderson. They're watching him one-on-one. And the linebacker, or the tight end, slipping in. Here comes the same formation again. We may see 87, Marvin Harvey, in that flat for about an 8 to 10-yard gain.
Nickelback is in for Jacksonville. Tom Dinkle, the linebacker, leaves, and an extra defensive back has been put in by Lindy Infante. John Reaves got some time over the middle, and he has his man, and that's Spencer Jackson, but Spencer slips down at the 29-yard line. Joe Costello there to make sure he doesn't get back up again.
This is the Fike Millard show. Watch Dan Fike on Keith Millard. Now, you got to understand. Well, you think he's got him by the shoulder pad here?
Nah.
Just for a second or two. Dan Fike, pretty good offensive lineman out of Florida.
You know what Dan Fike's got on? He's got white gloves on, and it blends right in with the white shirt of Keith Millard, and it's tough for the official to see that. Not too tough.
You got to get every edge you can.
That's
third
right.
Down and 6 at the 28-yard line. You got Brodsky, Jim Fitzpatrick. Split out.
Oh, snap the ball.
Somebody was offside somewhere. Were they drawn or not? Meanwhile, the Bandits go through with the play. Anderson has the first down. Keep that in mind.
See, here's another coaching point for you young people out there. If you're on defense and something happens, your people go offside, don't stop. And that's what the Jacksonville Bulls defense did. They stopped. They enabled Gary Anderson to go get the first down, because even with the penalty right there, it wouldn't have been a first down. It would have been about a yard and a half short. But this way, Gary Anderson picks up. Did he pick up the first down? I think he did.
Yes, he did. Now let's just hear.
Offsides, number 93 on the defense. First down.
Keith Millard is the guilty party, and it's a first down.
But he's trying to get by the holding. I need a little extra step. But the defense, if you noticed on that play, Tom, the defense stopped. because they knew they were offside. Gary Anderson. Reaves goes right ahead with the play, toss to Anderson. He picks up the 7 yards for the first down.
First and 10 at the 21-yard line. The Tampa Bay Bandits with their second concerted drive in a row. They're tied at 7. Anderson, the only setback. Here's the give to Gary. Cuts back. Held to a gain of maybe 1.5 yards on the play. Keith Millard and Tom Dinkle combining for that tackle. 2:08 to go on the clock running. That may have been the last play before the 2-minute warning. And it was. So we have reached the 2-minute mark to go in the first half of play. Our score, Tampa Bay 7, Jacksonville 7.
Oh, I'll tell you, Chester G is there, but Spencer Jackson, you talk about going down and getting the football. Now, Reaves, play action, fake to Gary Anderson, and he's looking for Spencer Jackson the entire way, and he puts this ball down low in a way where you really can't get to the ball. Look at that. He goes down, cradles it. Chester G has no chance at all because he had excellent coverage.
First and goal for the Bandits at the 1-yard line, and this is usually Gary Anderson territory. Why not? Larry Bronski trots out of the lineup now. Anderson is in there with Greg Boone, who usually acts as the blocking back in this goal line situation. Let's see if they do indeed give it to Gary Anderson.
I would think so.
It is Gary Anderson. He cuts back. He's got the touchdown. Anderson's 10th rushing touchdown of the year. He has every touchdown the Bandits have on the ground this season.
Well, who would you give it to?
Not too hard to guess, is it?
No, it is not. I'd give it to him.
Anderson has given the Bandits the 6-point lead.
And he's going to follow Boone in. Boone is right in front of him, number 21. He sees Boone go in. He just goes up and goes down underneath. And as that Tom Dinkle, number 52, he just carries him. Watch what Anderson, where he hits his legs right here. Just carries Tom Dinkle right into the end zone. Dinkle was high. Anderson went low. Touchdown.
Let me plug the little guy, wide receiver Spencer Jackson. Did you see that block he was making on Chester G, keeping him aware of Van Jakes? He kept the safety man from making the tackle.
You liked that, huh?
I like that. Zenon Andrusician, it's a high snap on the point after, but Jimmy Jordan does his job. He gets it down. Andrusician does his job, and he gets it through. Our score, Tampa Bay 14, the Jacksonville Bulls 7. A special look at the Los Angeles Express, a team that was thought to be one of the very best in the USFL when the season started, and they've had a lot of rocky sledding out in Los Angeles.
Well, had so many injuries, Tom, and they can't really go get anybody.
All right, Zenon Andrusician with a kickoff after the Bandit touchdown. This is Perry Kemp at his own 5-yard line. Kemp over the 20, 25. Bobby Futrell brings him down at the 28-yard line. First and 10, and Mr. Anderson can say hi to all the folks back at the University of Arkansas.
You're a good one, young man. Here's that replay again. Now watch what he does when he hits that hole. That's Marvin Harvey is getting an excellent block. He's just standing his man up at the line of scrimmage. And once you do that, that's Tom Dinkle, 52. Then Anderson just took his legs out with his body and pushed himself into the end zone. Combination there, huh?
Quite a combination.
They can play catch all night.
Well, John Reaves, you know, had a 410-yard throwing effort against New Jersey a couple of weeks ago, and he's really on his game. First and 10 at the 28-yard line for Jacksonville. Get a look at Ed Luther running the 2-minute offense for the Bulls. Got plenty of time, Luther does. He's headed up the left sideline for Gary Clark, but over there guarding him step for step was Alonzo Johnson, and it'll go incomplete. It'll be second down and 10. Ed Luther signing just a few weeks ago. He's out of San Jose State, but we remember him best the last couple of years, ball backing up Dan Fouts of the San Diego Chargers.
He got a chance to play quite a bit because Fouts got hurt, you know, a few times. And again, in all defense to Ed Luther is the fact that he's learning a new system, and you just don't come in. I don't care how smart you are. You just don't come in and know the system right away.
Second down and 10 after the incomplete pass. Luther sends everybody out on pass patterns again, and this is Alton Alexis. Alexis up the sideline, stops the clock as he steps out near the first down mark at about the 37-yard line. It'll be about a yard to go for the first. Third down and 1 coming up.
And just to remind everybody, Tom, that inside the 2 minutes of the half and at the end of the game in the fourth quarter, the clock stops after every first down. That one stops because they went out of bounds, obviously, but it stops after every first down just till they move the chains and set the marker, and then it goes again. So Jacksonville, they still have 3 timeouts, 1:05, and they can stop the clock every time they get a first down.
Third and 1 at the 37. Harry Mason and Marvin Lewis are in there now, setback position. Morris Brown, tight end, goes in motion for blocking purposes to give us to Mason. Mason's got the first down over the 40, up to the 41-yard line. Mike Butler is on top of him. When he's on top of you, you don't move very much. There is a timeout now called by the Jacksonville Bulls with 59 seconds left to go in the first half. Of course, Lindy Infante trying to figure out a way to move that ball downfield. The Bulls, Paul, intercepting two passes in the first quarter off of John Reaves, missing a first a field goal attempt. I'd love to get out of here with at least a field goal, but the time's a-wasting. They still have two timeouts left. Ed Luther down the right sideline, has his man, and out of bounds goes Perry Kemp. Time for the Bulls to get within Brian Franco's field goal range, if indeed they can't score. Luther going to the right side. It's picked off by James Harrell. Intercepted. And Harrell is out of bounds at the 45-yard line.
He went out of bounds at the 35-yard line, actually.
But he does have the interception. Remember, Ed Luther had five interceptions last week, many of them coming in situations like this.
Well, here comes Luther again. Now, watch. Here's the thing, the mistake he makes. He's looking. He looks to his left first, and he's going right back to Perry Kemp again. But that time, when James Harrell gets deep enough, he's right in the position between the receiver and the quarterback, makes the play, runs out of bounds at about the 36, but it's first down.
Pass to Gary Anderson. He's got some blocking. Anderson is chopped down at the 43-yard line. And the clock rolls under 10 seconds to go. That may have been the last play of the first half, but we have a timeout call. Now, Carter had a 52-yard touchdown reception earlier this year against San Antonio. Reaves back to throw. Got some time. And he's got his man Fitzpatrick. Jim Fitzpatrick with 3 seconds left. He's out of bounds with a first down at the 40-yard line.
Now you got 3 seconds.
Everybody out on pass patterns. Reaves. It is incomplete. Looking for Brodsky down at about the 8-yard line. It looked like a bunch of bowling pins hitting together, and the football falls harmlessly to the turf. We've reached the end of the first half in Tampa. The Bandit fans are on their feet. Our score, Tampa Bay 14, Jacksonville Bulls 7. Taken at the 15-yard line by Perry Kemp of the Bulls. He's got an alley. Look out. He bumps into his own man. And Kemp has wrestled down near the 40-yard line. Mark it at the 39, so good field position for the Bulls.
All right, the Jacksonville possessions. Just take a look at it now. They had the ball on an interception at Tampa Bay's 21-yard line. The first two possessions they had were in Tampa Bay territory. They came away with one touchdown and missed field goal. Then at 10 plays, they had the punt, fumble. All right, they were on a move again when they fumbled. Then they started on their own 28 and 29. So they did well at the beginning, but they didn't do much in the second quarter.
Well, let's see how they do at the beginning of the second half. 14-7, and they start at their own 38-yard line. First down and 10 for the Bulls. 2-4 coming into this game. Luther has a man open. That's Alton Alexis. Alexis gets around Alonzo Johnson, but he's roped down by Alvin Bailey. So no further damage as far as Tampa Bay's defense is concerned. Give Alexis a gain of around 6.
Al Richardson, number 59, said, I have him, I don't have him, I have him. Which is Alton Alexis. All he's doing is going down about 5 yards, just sitting to the outside. The corners are staying way off. Here comes Alonzo Johnson. He misses him. Al Richardson misses him. And then finally, Alvin Bailey comes up and makes the play. But actually, that time, Alexis lost about 2 yards dancing around.
So second down and 5 for Ed Luther. Pressure, tries to dump it off to Rozier over the middle, but too much pressure by Mike Butler, who puts him down on the grass. 3rd and 5.
Someone just forgot to block Mike Butler because Butler came in free, and Luther, that's experienced quarterback. Instead of eating the ball and taking the loss, he just dumped the ball away. There was a man in the area who was Mike Rozier. As long as he's in the area, you can throw the ball away.
Word from the Tampa Bay Bandit bench, the linebacker Kelly Kirchbaum, who left the field injured in the first half, will not be back, and you were right on the money, Paul. Hyperextended elbow, so Kirchbaum, number 51, and a very active tackler, not back tonight for the Bandits. 3rd down and 5 for Jacksonville. Luther looking left all the way. He's looking for Perry Kemp, and Kemp has the ball to first down to the 35-yard line. Actually, they're going to say he stepped out at the 36. Marcus Quinn knocks him out of bounds. Perry Kemp doing all right tonight.
Yeah, but I'll tell you what. When you give Ed Luther this much time, he's going to find a man open, and Perry Kemp is fast. He's got good moves, but watch this offensive line now. Here's the blocking up front. No one really doing anything. Mike Morgan, he doesn't get by. They just sealed everything off in the middle. Luther has enough time, hits Kemp. Marcus Quinn comes up, but that's just too late.
Barry Kemp, 5'11", 165-pounder, a small wide receiver, second year out of Cal State Fullerton. 1st and 10 for Jacksonville at the Tampa Bay 36. Hunter dumps it out to Mason in the flat. Mason has one touchdown tonight, but he's not going anywhere near the goal line. He's planted at the 35 by Alonzo Johnson.
Alonzo Johnson makes the tackle, but the man that really made the play was Al Richardson, 59, the linebacker. He forced Mason back to the inside to where he had some help. And a lot of times you see that 59 right there, Al Richardson doesn't get credit for the tackle, but he's the man that actually makes the play.
Gain of only 2 yards on the pass play. Brings up second down and 8 at the 34. Concerned Linda Infante looking on from the Jacksonville sideline. Lewis in the slot. Three wide receivers now. Rozier the only setback, but he's going out on the pass pattern. It is complete to Alton Alexis, who steps out of bounds immediately just short of the 30-yard line. Alvin Bailey is in the area to drive him out. Still well short of the first down. About 5 yards short. Ed Luther's numbers on the night.
Not too bad. Not too bad. He's had a few knocked down, and about two or three different times he actually threw the ball away. But they count as incompleted passes.
14-7 our score. Mac Rozier leaves the lineup. An extra receiver coming in now. Now we have a whistle and a timeout has been called for by Jacksonville. Some confusion going on and off the field there. 12:56 to go in the third quarter. 4-2 football teams, only a game out of first, 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific time. Paul McGuire and Jim Simpson will be in the Mile High City Monday night.
Well, a run and shoot with Denver, but they're going against the number one pass defense in the USFL, the Arizona Outlaws.
Big play here for the Jacksonville Bulls, 3rd and 4, their initial drive of the second half. Whistles and flags all over the place.
That's going to be offense.
Well, we'll have to...
Well, you don't stop the play on the defense.
Mike Morgan might have been the guilty party.
Ball start, number 75 on the offense.
Wesley Ward makes the call. Offside, it's Bob Gruber. Bob Gruber, left tackle for Jacksonville. And there's a former, that guy has got to be a former play-by-play man, Paul.
See, beautiful.
Revealing his true self to the nation.
All right, big guy, have a good time.
Oh, he is that, I guarantee you. I don't know if he knows what stadium he's in, but he's having a great time. 3rd down and 9 after the penalty on Gruber at the 35. Luther. Sideline has Alexis, but underthrows him. It's intercepted by Alvin Bailey, and Bailey takes it back to the 22-yard line where Marvin Lewis brings him down. So the second interception of the night for Ed Luther and the Bulls. 12:47 to go in the third quarter. Tampa Bay 14. Jagger 23-yard line after the interception by Alvin Bailey. Reeves comes out throwing, has a man, and that is Larry Bronski up at the 32-33-yard line. Mark Harper brings him down. Bronski, though, is near the first down marker, about a yard short.
Well, Mark Harper's got his hands full. Number one, this man does run. He precision moves. Now watch it. He knows where the first down marker is. Look, he's right at the first down marker. He should have it. They do give it to him. Brodsky's there. Harper has no chance at it. But this shows me a disciplined runner. Dan Fike, the left tackle, just came out of the game limping.
Dave Piles are going to replace him. Second-year man out of Miami of Ohio, number 72 now at left tackle. Reaves is hot. He's completed 11 of his last 13. Hands off here to Gary Anderson, who stacked up for little or no game. Curtis Anderson is in there. Terry Beeson is in there. And Joe Costello gets up from the bottom of the pile. 2nd down and 9. Gain of 1. Anderson, not very impressive numbers. 22 yards and 11 rushes, but he's picked up a lot more as a pass receiver tonight. And, of course, one of those one-yard runs resulted in a Bandit touchdown. 2nd down and 9 at the 37. Boone and Anderson to setbacks. They better get the play off in a hurry. 4 seconds on the 32nd clock. Reeves does so. Everybody out on a pass pattern. Over the middle, it is incomplete. Greg Boone was in the area. Gary Anderson was in the area. And let's take a look at what John Reaves and company did in the first half.
Well, they started out very slow. And when I say slow, 2 interceptions and then 2 punts. But take a look. 6 plays touchdown. And they took the ball always in their own territory. The best yardage they had was at their own 36, where they started for that halftime deal. And they moved the ball well. But they really put it together right near the end of the first half, where, on the other hand, Jacksonville did not.
Well, big third down play for John Reaves and company. 15 of 27 in the game. Excellent totals so far. Jacksonville defense wants to dig in and get the football right back. Reaves looking left all the way. Has Spencer Jackson, and Jackson's got the first down. He's over the 45 to the 46-yard line. Quick feet by Jackson. Van Jakes forces him out.
You know, this is not only a nice throw and a nice catch, but to have presence of mind of where you are to keep the ball in bounds and get your first down. All right, here we're looking on the other side now. We got Piles, who's blocking on Millard, along with Pitcock and everyone else. And here's the catch. Now, just take a look at what Spencer does. See that, Tom? To have enough presence of mind to find that red marker, to know where you are to get the first down, because he was 2 yards short when he caught the ball.
Spencer Jackson wearing his jersey that he wore in England at a postseason exhibition game. He's got the little Union Jack right below his number on his chest. First down and 10 for the Bandits at the 46. John Reaves doesn't seem to know what's going on with the defense. Reaves out in the flat to Ricky Williams, who's back in the game now. Ricky Williams gets away, and Williams is into the Jacksonville territory at the 45-yard line. Vaughn Johnson and Van Jakes make the tackle. A reminder. Well, we'll remind you about college baseball in a moment.
All right, well, Ricky Williams in the backfield with Gary Anderson. Now, the heat is on Gary Anderson. There is good blocking outside. Look at Newton, 61. He gets an excellent block, but the running of Ricky Williams cuts back in, picks up about 9 yards. Now is a position you don't know what they're going to do because you've got second and short. What a great time for play action.
Well, one thing I know they're not going to do is give the ball to Gary Anderson. He's left the game now. Ricky Williams and Greg Boone are the setbacks behind Reaves. Nothing wrong with Anderson. He's just taking a rest. Here's Williams again, and Williams picks up the first down. That is just about to the 40-yard line. Keith Millard makes the tackle. John Reaves goes left, however, and he is intending the ball for Larry Brodsky. Mark Harper over there, and the two do not make connections. Goes in. Reaves to Anderson. And if Gary Anderson would have kept his balance, he may have gone the route. As it was, he gets to the 35-yard line.
Uh-oh, Nate. Get up, Nate.
Nathaniel Newton, all 295 pounds of him.
Newton. I'll tell you, that time, Terry Beeson, he comes running up to make the tackle, and Gary Anderson disappeared. There's Nathaniel Newton. He just misses his block. Well, no, he's got him. He's got a hold on the defensive lineman, Costello. And then, what?
Oh, you got to go. You got to go.
Fourth and inches.
Boone. But you're going to they put Boone in there, and you give the ball to Anderson.
Well, there's not much doubt with the kind of offense the Tampa Bay Bandits run that they're not going to try the field goal here. They're going to go for it.
Good news, Dan Fike is back in the game at the left tackle, so they may go to that side where Pitcock and Fike are, but they seem to be having more success going right on the side of Reggie Smith and Nathaniel Newton.
Now we'll see how the Bandits play it. Do you go conservative here and give it to your bread and butter man, Gary Anderson, or do you try and cross up the secondary? Fourth and one at the 31 of Jacksonville. Actually, fourth and inches.
I go left.
Anderson to the left. Anderson's got the first down to the 28-yard line, and Coach McGuire, you're right again. Vaughn Johnson trips him up.
Well, I think the play was called either left or right, depending on what the defense, but take a look at the gap on the right-hand side of the defense, the left-hand side of the offense. They blocked very well in the hole. Boone gets an excellent block on the outside. Watch 21. He sacrifices his body. You're going to see a guy fly over right there. That's Boone's block on number 50, Terry Beeson. Gary Anderson picks up the first down.
Mark Harper actually locked arms around the legs of Gary Anderson. And a closer look. First down and 10 for the Bandits at the 28-yard line. The pitch out to Anderson on the fake reverse. Gary Anderson's got a hole. He's inside the 20 to the 19-yard line. I tell you, Spencer Jackson and Gary Anderson executing the fake reverse to perfection.
Well, here's a play that picks up 9 yards. Gary Anderson wants out. He's tired. But if he gives it on a reverse, Spencer Jackson might still be running. But take a look at Marvin Harvey, number 87. There's the good block on the outside. Gary Anderson, if he gets by Van Jakes, he's got touchdown.
Van Jakes and Terry Beeson also hitting him. So it's second down and one at the 19-yard line.
Williams is now in the game. Anderson out. He's in the backfield. Now Boone's in the backfield. Williams is split out.
Ricky Williams, interesting young man. Interesting story. We had some time. I'll tell you a little bit about number 44. Give us the great Boone up the middle, and you're going to hear the Boone cheer as he picks up the needed yardage for the first down. Vaughn Johnson and Keith Millard.
Well, that's the first time tonight that Boone, I think, has touched the football. The thing about Boone is he came in overweight. He is still overweight, and they're not happy about it.
No, they're not. He's an excellent blocker, but he's been in and out of Steve Spurrier's doghouse. But he does pick up the first down here. It's first and 10 Tampa Bay at the Jacksonville 16. Clock running steadily down. 6:30 to go now in the third period. The give is to Ricky Williams. Williams down at the 16-yard line. Bob Nelson, nose tackle, stops Ricky.
Well, Ricky Williams, this is the way you do not want to run into a hole with your back going in first, because you take that pop and the ball's gone. He tried to jump, and when Ricky Williams jumped, he turned, and he was lucky not to get hit in the back.
Jim Fitzpatrick comes in at a wide receiver now, replacing Ricky Williams. Williams was an excellent performer for Bobby Bowden up at Florida State. Had a bad knee injury his rookie season here at Tampa Bay. Limited his mobility, but he's come back from that injury. He's a very explosive runner, especially when he gets a crack and into the open field. Second down and 10 now at the Jacksonville 16. Reaves has everybody going, including the fullback Boom, and he's going for the end zone, and it's batted away. Intended for Spencer Jackson. Don Vesalu, the free safety, and also Chester G in the area. It was G that batted the pass down.
Chester G he comes up limping. Take a look at this pass, though. It's perfect to the outside. Chester G with just a great effort to knock the ball away. Keith Bullard is in his face. But watch Chester G just at the last second. Now, remember once before when he didn't go for the interception, made the tackle? This time he went to knock the ball away because he knew that he had a chance of knocking the ball away.
Gary Anderson walking off what appears to be a limp.
Oh, I think it's cramps, because when they start dropping their socks like that, they give some breathing room in their leg.
This is the 16th play of this drive for the Tampa Bay Bandits. Third and 10 at the 16 of Jacksonville. The pass intended for Ricky Williams, batted down by Vaughn Johnson. And now Zenon Andrasicion will come on to attempt a field goal. So the Bull defense doing their job well, Paul.
Seems a little different team when Gary Anderson is not in the ballgame, doesn't it?
But yes, it does.
We just saw two great plays. One by Chester G, and then come back by Vaughn Johnson, number 33.
So, Zenon Andrasicion, the wily old veteran out of UCLA. Well, he is. He's 16 years in pro football. Don't you become wily after that long in the game? No comment. All right, he's attempting a 33-yard field goal, angle to the right.
He's going to be mad at you, not me.
Jimmy Jordan with the hold. It's plenty long enough, and the kick is good by Zenon Andrasicion. So Z has put three more on the board for the Bandits. 5:32 to go in the third quarter. Our score, Tampa Bay 17, Jacksonville. Call it affectionately Bandit Ball in Tampa Bay, and the Bandits have a 10-point lead with 5:32 to go in the third quarter. Zenon Andrasicion preparing to kick off for the Bandits. Back to receive, Reggie Bunson, Perry Kemp for the Jacksonville Bulls. I'm Tom Meese with Paul McGuire, and again, another short kickoff by Zenon Andrasicion as Butts takes it at the 13. And Butts is nailed short of the 30 at the 28-yard line. Tony Office, who's a real headhunter on special teams, makes the stop. And we have some tempers flaring on the field.
They have some pushing and shoving, a little dancing. They like to dance once in a while, just get loose. The guys that don't play a lot get down there and dance.
Is that what they do?
That's right. There's no strong hits or anything. They ain't going to push and shove.
All right. Now, Ed Luther, Paul, he comes in first and 10. He's got good field position again. They're going to mark it at near the 30-yard line. He's seen Tampa Bay go on a 16-play, 7-minute, 15-second drive. He's down by 10. What does he do?
Well, you go back to throwing the ball to Alton Alexis, number 89, for the simple reason that Alvin Bailey plays him anywhere from 8 to 10 yards off.
Yeah, we'll see if that's what happens. First and 10 at the 30. Luther to Rozier on the delay. Mike Rozier over the 30 to the 34-yard line. Fred Norgren puts him down there after about a 4-yard gain. Freddie Norgren he's like a gnat, a big one, albeit. He's all over the field. He leads this team in sacks on the year. He has 7 coming into this game. And there he has the mobility to catch up to a guy like Rozier.
And credit him with the last interception by Alvin Bailey. And the man does it all. And I guess the word is overachiever.
Yep.
Is that two words?
No, that's one word. Maybe a hyphen in there.
Okay, I like it.
Second down and 6 from the 34. Norgren out of Portland State, in case you're wondering. Luther has lots of time. Rolling right. Norgren puts the pressure on now. Rozier tries to hang on to it. It's incomplete. A flag has been dropped at the 28-yard line.
You know, we talk about Norgren, Tommy, and I'm going to tell you something. The man never stops. He was blocked at the line of scrimmage. He was also the man that got into Ed Luther's face. And he keeps hustling. He forced the play, the bad throw, and I think we got a holding penalty, do we?
Chop.
Chop block.
All right, good call.
Chop.
A chop block on the center, Jay Pennison.
Good call, good call.
And the Bandits say, good call.
Yeah. All right, but watch who's going to end up in Ed Luther's face. And that's going to be number 68. Not there. Coming right about now is Freddie Norgren, and he is humming. Bang, he gets to his legs, causes the bad throw.
And there he is, Freddie Norgren. Played at the school where Mouse Davis used to be a head football coach at Portland State. Neil Lomax was one of Mouse Davis's pupils at Portland State. So after the penalty to center Jay Pennison, the Bulls are backed up a bit. Second down and 21, but at their own 19-yard line. You can see the penalties have hurt Jacksonville tonight far more than Tampa Bay. Luther, plenty of time this time, stays in the pocket and completes the pass to the 30-yard line to his tight end, Mark Keel, but Keel is hit like a truck by Kevin McClellan.
Keel said, wait a minute, if you're going to throw that ball to me in the middle of the field, you got to make sure they're not three linebackers sitting there in my face that want to kill me.
Kevin McClellan is the man who made the hit that time. He is a second-year pro at the University of Kentucky, 6'1", 219. Marginal gain on the play, third down and 10. They're back to the original line of scrimmage. Of nine on that play. Aubrey Matthews split out wide now to the top of your screen for the Bulls. Luther over the middle again, and again he has his tight end, and that is Keel. Now the question is, does he have the first down? I don't believe so, as Kevin McClellan was right on him again.
First of all, they're going to give Keel a great mark on his catch, but Keel, he's got to think about where you... Remember when we showed Jabrotsky going down and making the catch, getting beyond the 10-yard? Well, here, Keel's got to be aware of where the 10-yard marker was. He had to go down. If he's going to come back, you go down 11 or 12, then you come back to that 1 or 2 yards that you have to come back to.
Steve Spurrier is very upset at where the officials marked this football. He thinks the Bulls got a favorable mark, and we'll see how favorable when they come in to measure it.
He didn't make it.
Nope, he didn't make it. He didn't miss it by much. It'll be fourth and inches, ball in Jacksonville territory, just short of the 40. And
they're going to go for it again.
Well, let's see. I was looking for Larry Swider. He's the punter, number four, been warming up on the sidelines. But Lindy Infante, you're right, Paul, is going to go for it.
I'll tell you, this takes a lot of guts by a coach because you're only down 10 points right now. If you turn this ball over to Tampa at the 40-yard line, you've got a lot of problems on your hands, especially with Tampa's offense.
Last time the Bulls went for it on fourth and inches, Mike Rozier was given the football, and he was stopped. That was back in the second quarter. Let's see what happens now. 3:02 to go, third quarter. Biggest play of the game so far for Jacksonville.
Luther should just keep it.
Tight end in motion, give to Rozier, and this time Mike Rozier has it. He falls forward 3 or 4 yards, and he'll have the first down up at the 43-yard line. Bruce Vaughn in the area, along with James Harrell. Lindy Infante, former offensive coordinator of the Cincinnati Bengals, leaving at the time a very successful team to come down here to the USFL. And a very successful franchise in Jacksonville. They led the league in attendance last year. And are averaging 41,000 a game this year.
If I don't respond to you sometimes, that's because I can't hear you.
Okay.
My headset.
Just, I'm glad you told me that. That's why I won't be offended. First and 10 for Jacksonville on its own 43. The give is to Rozier. He's got some room. Mike Rozier bowling over Bruce Vaughn. He's inside the 40 to the 39. The best run of the night for the former Heisman Trophy winner. Marcus Quinn brings him down. First and 10, Jacksonville.
And we've got a flag downfield. Is that face mask?
Well, we'll see.
Yeah, all right, take a look at Norgren. He takes a side. When Norgren takes a side and Mike Clark comes down, they both miss him right there. That's what opens up the middle. Watch, the cross-blocking of the two guards. They kick out. Norgren misses right in the backfield. Now, there are no linebackers there. Alonzo Johnson, remember, he is an outside linebacker. The inside linebackers did not make the play. And there's Rozier downfield. We've got a face mask. Another five.
James Harrell called for a face mask, so they walk it off to the Tampa Bay 34-yard line. Three busloads of Jacksonville Bulls fans are sitting across the way at the goal line to our right. And they are chanting, "Let's go, Bulls." And they are going first and 10 at the 33. Luther again to Rozier, playing the hot hand, and Rozier down to the 30-yard line. Ball comes loose, but no fumble. They're going to rule no fumble because, Paul, as we all know, the ground cannot cause a fumble. Norgren on the tackle.
The ground cannot cause a fumble, but are you going, is he going down when the ball comes out? Let's just take a look. Now, here comes Rozier, the quick draw. Here's Norgren. He is making the play on the outside. Now, take a look at the ball. The ball was coming out as he was going down. The ground did not cause the fumble. He fumbled the football.
Well, Jacksonville then gets a break. Gain of three, second down and seven at the Tampa Bay 30. Again, it's Rozier. They're going to play the hot hand till he's stopped, and Rozier is stopped this time. Mike Clark getting in there to help kill things. And
Al Richardson.
Yep, and there's one of the high school bands on hand tonight. And they are from Jacksonville, so they are whooping it up on the far sidelines. Third down and six. Gain of one for Rozier on that last play. Al Richardson was the man getting up at the bottom of the pile for Tampa Bay. You can see the Bulls are 3 for 7 in third down conversions of 3 yards or more. And it's third down and six. I'd like to even that average up to 500 right now. Luther, plenty of time. Under pressure now, unloads the keel, the tight end. He has it, but does he have the first down?
Yes, I believe he does.
Down at the 23-yard line. Keel is brought down. Alonzo Johnson was in the area, and so was Al Richardson.
Well, that time, Ed Luther had enough time to throw the football. He was looking out to his two wideouts outside. One was Clark. The other one was Alton Alexis, number 89. But he just waited, and found Keel.
That's the end of the third quarter. Our score, Tampa Bay Bandits 17, the Jacksonville Bulls 7. No, we're not at the circus, and that lady is eating cotton candy, but she's at a USFL football game as we start the fourth quarter, and the Jacksonville Bulls threatening, trailing Tampa Bay 17-7, but they have it first and 10 on the Bandit 23 as Ed Luther goes back to pass. He's got his man. That's Kemp in the flat. Kemp inside the 15, takes a hard hit, and keeps on rolling down around the 12-yard line. A host of Bandits in the area, Bruce Vaughn, left cornerback coming up to help bring Kemp down, and that's a first down as we take another look at it.
We've been seeing this all night long. Take a look at, he's just drifting off the line, and Bruce Vaughn is not even staying close to him. He's just letting him drift. Now watch the moves that Perry Kemp makes back to the inside. He just goes around three different people, office misses, but Alonzo Johnson, number 58, comes in and makes the smack.
He makes the smack from the bottom. Bruce Vaughn gets him at the top, and the result is a Jacksonville Bull first down at the Tampa Bay 11. Had the feeling that Ed Luther and his offense were going to put it together in a couple of nice drives tonight without the benefit of any turnovers, and they've done it here at the end of the third quarter, now the start of the fourth. They can get a first down without a touchdown. Here goes Mike Rozier. Rozier inside the 10 to the 7 to the 6-yard line. Tony Office making the tackle along with Dwayne Anderson.
And they had a blitz on here. You're going to see a blitz coming up, and right there by Office, he blitzes. He's the man that actually opens up the hole, and then Mike Rozier goes down and picks up a few yards, tackled by Dwayne Anderson, but he picked up almost 5 yards on the play.
Second down and five just outside the Tampa Bay 5-yard line. Bandits rushing in some fresh troops now. More or less a goal line defense in this situation.
Almost had too many fresh troops.
Yeah. Tim King had to run off before they were called for too many men on the field.
You got a linebacker covering Alexis.
Luther to Clark, and Clark has the reception inside the 5 to the 3-yard line. Alonzo Johnson on the tackle. He's short of the first down.
They had to have a mix-up on the play because they had Alonzo Johnson, number 58, lined up on Alton Alexis covering a wide receiver, and that doesn't happen.
Not without disastrous results if you're Tampa Bay. Let's take another look, and actually they ruled out the pass was incomplete.
All right, just take a look at it. Now Luther's going to throw outside. Alonzo Johnson, if you're going to catch it, you're going to pay. Take a look here. The ball was, I don't even know where that was even in a question.
Well, it wasn't. It went through his hands. I did not see it with a bad angle. That's what happened. So it brings up a third and five.
Well, your bad eye.
Well, a couple of them on that play. Luther rolling right.
Look out. You got a man in the
end zone. I don't know who that was intended for. Perry Kemp was in the area, but that man again, Paul, Freddie Norgren, was putting pressure on Ed Luther.
When you can let Fred Norgren tee off and he knows you're going to throw the football, just watch the man in action. Fred Norgren is going to be in Luther's face. They've got people rolling out. Rozier's there, but he has to throw the ball away because number 68 is playing a tremendous football game.
Well, Brian Franco, who's been a tremendous place kicker for the Jacksonville Bulls this season, he's perfect from this distance, 20 to 29. The ball will be kicked from the 12. It's a 22-yard attempt, angled to the right to bring Jacksonville within a touchdown. Larry Swider is your holder. The kick is good with 13-17 left in the ball game. Jacksonville is pulled within a touchdown. Our score, Tampa Bay 17, Jacksonville 10. Field goal pulled within a 7-point deficit at 17-10. Franco preparing to kick off, and the two gentlemen back to receive the kickoff, Bobby Futrell At the lower part of your screen, Ricky Williams at the top part of your screen for Tampa Bay.
Good kick.
Ball goes into Williams' direction. It's an excellent kick ball. Halfway deep in the end zone, and Williams takes Bobby Futrell's advice and downs it first and 10. Bandits at their own 20. Well, the Jacksonville Bull defense now, obviously hoping to contain Tampa Bay's offense. You know, Tampa Bay and this man, John Reaves, got it going at the end of the first half, and this is about the time of the game when they ought to do it again if they want to salt this away.
He's got some pretty good numbers, 17-32 over 200 yards, but Gary Anderson is back in the backfield. Also, Boone is back there, and now you got to start using Anderson again because he's the man that does it all for you.
Tampa Bay coming into this game 4-2, a game behind Birmingham in the Eastern Conference. Jacksonville 2-4, but with the win, they could tie Memphis. Memphis losing to Orlando Thursday night, to drop to 3-4. Reaves on a short drop. Going to the left side to Brutsky. He's got it near the first down marker. Mark Harper in the area, and we have a flag on the play.
Deal, face mask deal.
Wesley Ward comes over to get the information.
Number 40 on the defense, 5 yards.
Mark Harper.
He's a little frustrated, Mark Harper, because Broski's just doing numbers on him. And again, let me point out on that turn into Broski's, he went down 11 yards, turned back, got the first down, and then tackled, picked up an extra 5 on the face mask.
Look at what John Reaves has done the last 2 weeks, 307 against Memphis, 410. That came 2 weeks ago against the New Jersey Generals in a losing cause.
Well, he's got to get 2 possessions in his fourth quarter to get over, because he can only get 80 if he throws for the all 80 of them. But I imagine you're going to give the ball to Gary Anderson sometime.
Well, Anderson's in the backfield now. The backs are split, not in the I formation. He and Greg Boone. First and 10 at the 35. Reaves throws to the right. Spencer Jackson, he's had a good night. He gets away. And Jackson is over midfield. He got away from Van Jakes, and Don Vesselil had to put him out, but not until he gets into Jacksonville territory.
They're reading the defenses very well. You're catching Spencer Jackson now on one-on-one coverage, because if you take a look at Reaves, he's looking at Spencer Jackson the entire way. Watch the move he puts on Van Jakes. Bang. There's a miss. Vesselil was there. Spencer wasn't going anywhere. Spencer Jackson said, let's get out of bounds. I don't want to get hit in the head.
Getting out of here.
Looks like he always looks like he's got an upset stomach. He's going to wear his hair out.
He wasn't too upset about preparing for this game. He was out playing golf yesterday. We have an officials timeout for the time being.
There is absolutely no one in all of football that's any more laid back than Steve Spurrier. I can guarantee you that.
Wesley Ward coming over to have a conference at the sidelines. Unclear yet as why the stoppage of play. There's 12:02 to go. Nobody called a timeout. Mr. Ward has been satisfied.
Something wrong with the clock?
Not that I've been able to see.
They're looking at the clock.
Well, the 30-second clock is stuck on 16.
Yeah.
Maybe that's what it is.
Let's hear it. Sure, rough.
Well, there it is. Stuck on 16, and so now what he's doing is alerting both sidelines that the 30 seconds is going to be kept manually on the field.
Clock should read 12 minutes, 28 seconds.
Well, now the game clock is what he's adjusting. It says 12:02 right now, and he wants 26 seconds put back on it.
Well, they didn't stop the clock when Spencer Jackson got out of bounds, and that's what the problem is. But again, you're right. The 30-second clock is on 16.
And the clock operator now has to put some time on the clock, and we'll be all set to go.
Well, they made some new rules. That isn't a rule now. If you're ahead, you only get 16 seconds.
No.
I was going to say,
that's a new one on me.
Yeah, I've changed some rules during the course of the year, which are good rules, too.
Of course, they expanded the number of instances where you can call for a challenge of an official's call.
You know, it's always, you always say, you know, you have 3 timeouts per half, but actually you have 4.
2-minute warnings.
The 2-minute warnings each one, plus all the television timeouts.
That's right.
So you have a whole bunch.
Well, each team right now officially has 2 timeouts left. The clock still shows 12:02. And a lot of standing around going on the football field now. Let's take a look at some of the big stories in the United States Football League. Of course, last Thursday night, Orlando winning its first game ever in that city. Remember, they used to be the Washington Federals, beating Memphis. And Paul, Reggie Collier, well, he had a good overall game and a surprise to a lot of people, Orlando winning.
Is that now 7 touchdowns in 3 games? Did
something
he get one,
like
in the, one in the middle of that?
Mm-hmm. Yep,
then it'll
did.
Be 8. He had 4 in 1 game, didn't he?
He had 4 against the Jacksonville Bulls.
Okay, and then 3 there.
having a great time, huh, pal?
Rip Van Winkle is in attack.
Don't let all this excitement get to you.
All right. Clock is now straightened out, and so are we. We hold first and 10. Bandits at the 49, 12, 28 to go, and the handoff to fullback Greg Boone. All that time for a one-yard pickup by Boone. Bob Nelson and Mike Edwards drag down the fullback out of Duke.
You get the feeling they want to get the clock moving.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, time is on their side, but the Jacksonville Bulls are only one touchdown away, one turnover, one big play from tying this game up.
I got to believe that Brodsky, every time he comes off the field, he's got to say, hey, look, I'm working on Mark Harper, number 40, and he can't keep up with my moves. He's got speed, but I've got the moves. And he's out here one-on-one on Harper right now.
Two-yard gain for Boone on that play. Second down and 8 from the 47. Reaves going down the left sideline to Brodsky. He's got his man. Look out. Brodsky is knocked out of bounds at the 4-yard line. Don Vesalou saves the touchdown.
I'm going to get into coaching. I'm going to get into coaching from up here because it's so nice up here and it's less dangerous than anything else I know. He just ran down inside and broke back to the outside. And Larry Brodsky is eating Mark Harper alive. Take a look at it here. Harper can't stay with him. He almost had some help from Batiste, but that didn't do any good. Look at
he thought he was going to get into the end zone.
Oh, yeah. This look at, he's laughing. He's having a great time. 5 reception, 98 yards. I guess you are, young man. And a TD.
Paul, he set that up with all those short patterns early in the game, and he went long that time.
Well, he ran what they call, in the terminology of the football, a post corner. You run in towards the middle of the field, towards the goalpost, and then you break it back out to the corner where the flag is, and Reaves just put the pass right on the money. He couldn't do anything but catch it.
First and goal for the Bandits at the Jacksonville 4-yard line. Big play from Reaves to Larry Brodsky. And a pitch out for Anderson doesn't make connections, and Gary Anderson has the presence of mind to follow the football, but this is going to be a loss back to the 14-yard line.
Wouldn't it be a lot easier just to hand it to him?
Yeah, it would. He zigged when he should have zagged that time.
Well, you know, I mean, he's coming in your direction. Take a look at it. He turns around and tosses it to him, and he never got the ball. The ball went right by him, and it looked like, if you take a look at that play again, it looked like Gary Anderson had his arms folded like you're supposed to, as if the quarterback was going to stick it into his gut, and that time he didn't. Well, take a look at Anderson's arms. Now, see, it looks like his arms are up and down like this, and the ball, he throws the ball at him. He did the smart thing, though, fell on it.
Second down and 14 now, second and goal from the 14. Brodsky is back in the game for Tampa Bay. Over the middle, Reaves looking for Gary Anderson and just underthrown. Anderson had Vaughn Johnson on him at the 3-yard line. It'll be third and goal now.
Vaughn Johnson, I think he just hits him enough where Gary Anderson just trips his feet up a little bit. He can't really get to the ball, and the ball was a little bit away. But there was a blitz on. Reaves did not have enough time because you can see how wide open Anderson is, and I'd go right back to it.
Well, Jacksonville has taken out a couple of linebackers now and has 6 defensive backs in the game, 6 of them. Third and goal from the 14. All they're looking at here is to hold Tampa Bay to a field goal try. Reaves plenty of time. Over the middle. Anderson, touchdown!
What did I just tell you? Go right back to it. I mean, if the man opened one time, he's going to be open again.
Vaughn Johnson again had the coverage responsibility. And the Bandits lead it 23-10. Paul?
Gary Anderson coming out of the backfield. You see him sitting back there, 43. He just loops out of the backfield, puts a little move on, and Reaves knows he's wide open downfield. Just no way to cover him.
Well, Derek Batiste got there, but not till it was too late.
All right, here it comes again. Watch Anderson now. There's Johnson, number 33. He puts a move on him and left him right there.
Mm-hmm.
By the time Batiste got over, it's too late. It's touchdown.
Zen and Anderson hoping to add to his perfect string of extra points with 10:49 left to play. Low snap. Jimmy Jordan gets the kick down again, and Zen and Anderson gets it up and through the goalpost. 10:49 left in the game. The Bandits are back up by 2 touchdowns. Paul McGuire, there was a full moon in Memphis. Now there's a full moon in Tampa. What's going on?
Where is Vincent Price?
I don't know. I don't think he's back to receive Zen and Anderson's kickoff. I'll tell you that. Reggie Butts at the 10-yard line. Bulls need a big play here to get back in the game. Butts over the 25 to the 26-yard line, where he's brought down there by Holman, reserve running back Walter Holman for the Tampa Bay Bandits. So again, the Bulls will start out trailing, Paul, but with good field position.
Anytime you can get that ball out over the 25, you're in excellent field position. And one thing that Ed Luther must do now is that's to stay to the outside with Kemp, with Alexis, and with Matthews if he's in the game.
And always have your dump off man, which is the tight end, Keel.
All right, we'll see if he takes your advice here. First and 10, Bulls at their own 27. Larry Mason lined up at a running back position, but now he's a wide receiver to the right. Rozier, the only setback. Luther looking for his man, intercepted by Harrell. James Harrell, and he is hauled down by Mason at the 5-yard line.
Stepped out of bounds at the 20.
Well, now they're going to bring it back to near the 20, but Harrell does make the interception.
Well, Ed Luther did not read the linebacker and did not think that the linebacker is going to get, and that's James Harrell, number 50, in a position. They're going to the wideouts. He's looking all the way out here to Mason. Watch this. Watch the hands on Harrell. Tip it back into your gut. Grab the ball. You'll see him step out of bounds right there. His heel is out of bounds. Officials right on target.
Well, with 10:15 to go in the ball game, that is the third interception now for Ed Luther. And Luther was victimized on that play by James Harrell. But remember, Paul, he threw 5 INTs last week at Birmingham.
Yeah. And again, the linebacker was reading the quarterback, James Harrell, and when he sees that quarterback's eyes looking at one man, he's going to fly. Now, Lindy and Fonny talking to Luther.
Well, first and 10 for the Bandits at the Jacksonville 19. A score right here could be really disastrous. Anderson wants to throw it. He doesn't have anybody open, so now he's going to run it. And look at Gary Anderson. He's got the first down inside the 10. He's unbelievable.
Well, he was going to throw the ball, first of all, to Marvin Harvey. But Marvin Harvey couldn't get off the line of scrimmage, who was the tight end. So Gary Anderson does the smart thing. Take a look at him here. Here's a little toss. He's going to throw all away. It's all passed. But you see Marvin Harvey, number 87, he's stuck in the line of scrimmage. Now everybody's in his face.
Whoops.
Gets balance. Says, okay. Straight up is real nice. Let's take a shot up here. We'll pick up 11 yards. Is he strong? Is he strong?
Well, they mark it back right on the 10-yard line. I thought he got to the 9, but they marked it at the 10. So for the record, it's 2nd and 1. Brodsky and Spencer Jackson both split out to the top of your screen. Anderson is a splitter now to the left.
Give it to Booney.
Greg Boone, the lone setback. You see him behind John Reaves, the quarterback.
Booney.
There's Booney. He's got the first down. It's first and goal. Gain of a couple of yards. Terry Beeson and Tom Dinkle combined to bring him down.
They got Boone here at 5'9", 196, and that's a lie, folks.
He's over 200.
Oh, yes, indeedy.
Mm-hmm.
He's about 208, I guess, and they don't want him there.
Nathaniel Newton leaves the ballgame for Tampa Bay. He'll be replaced by Gerald Franklin at that right guard position. Franklin will wear number 69. And Lindy and Fonte cannot be happy at what he's seeing out there in the field.
Who's Carmen?
Carmen Infante is an old quarterback I knew at the University of Delaware. about 15 years ago when I was in school, he was a small college quarterback for Delaware. My apologies to Lindy.
I'll tell you, Lindy took his headset off. He is just livid because this team was in this football game all the way up until that interception.
First and goal, ball on the 7-yard line for Tampa Bay. Give it to Boone. This time Boone's going nowhere. Curtis Anderson, along with Vaughn Johnson, making the tackle.
Vaughn Johnson gave him a headache.
And this will bring up 2nd down and goal.
You know, I'm watching Gary Anderson running back in and out of the huddle, and I think those cramps are really still with him, and maybe that's why they don't have him back in the backfield with Boone. But you've got to at least make those people aware that he's back there so that you can get Boone doing something else. Now you got Anderson's going to come out here, and he's going to be one-on-one on Mark Harper.
Again, Gary Anderson is lining up as a split end to the bottom of your screen. He's out of the camera's vision right now. He's looking that way. Anderson, touchdown!
I could coach this game.
I'll tell you, that was rather obvious. Anderson was looking back. You could almost see his eyes getting big, like, give me the football.
Oh, yeah, and they went out there, and they said, all right, we'll put you out there. If they're going to try and cover, Harper hasn't been able to cover Brodsky all night. Take a look at this. Move outside, bink. Goodbye, Mark. Touchdown, Gary Anderson.
Mark Harper is having some problems, and so are the Jacksonville Bulls, Paul. They're now down by 20 with under 8 minutes to go.
And I blame the defense on that because you must give him some help. But, I mean, how many people can you double up on? If I'm going to double up one man, it's going to be Gary Anderson out there one-on-one.
That is a dilemma because you have Spencer Jackson with excellent speed going out there, Brodsky with excellent moves. Zen and Anderson. Snap is down, kick is up, and it's good as it has been every time this year. So, with 7:58 to go in the ballgame, the Bandits are on a roll. The score, Tampa Bay 31, Jacksonville 10.
On the return team.
Number 92 on the return team is Ike Griffin. He's a left defensive end, a backup defensive end. Another mistake for Jacksonville, and they've cost him.
Yeah, look at the miscues. Fumble, interception, interception, interception. Let's just take a look what it results in. That's the thing you look at. Touchdown, and of course it was halftime, and they were driving. Tampa Bay was driving then. Field goal and a touchdown. And, you know, talking to Coach Infante, and he was talking about Ed Luther, and he's saying, you know, he defending him, and he's not making excuses for him. There is a lot to learn. And you got to understand something. We said at the beginning, this team, in 2 years, this is the 10th quarterback on this football team.
Well, next Friday night is their next game, but we'll be at home, and it looks like they're going to be returning with a 2-5 record, and they're facing a band of San Antonio gunslingers that really looked impressive in their last game against Portland. Luther has to throw in almost every play, as his tight end Keel, and Keel is brought down by Tony Offis up at the 18-yard line.
They're going with a hurry-up offense right from the line of scrimmage, and here comes Tampa Bay trying to get a couple people on the field. They better get them up. They're trying to get four on.
And they're not going to get any of them.
No, they're not, because they're going with the hurry-up offense. That's what the hurry-up offense does. It keeps the defense from getting specialized people in certain situations.
7 minutes and counting in this ball game. Second down and one. They give it to Mason. Mason's got the first down. Three for Jacksonville on the 26. 31-10, our score, Tampa Bay in front.
This where Nordgren really shines is when he's got time to go ahead and go after the quarterback.
Luther, plenty of time. Over the middle, almost intercepted again by James Harrell, who picked off an Ed Luther aerial the last drive. Fourth down coming up.
Well, you go to the well too many times, and you're going to see look in the middle of your screen, you see Nordgren. He's going to loop around the outside. No effect at all. They're going to try and throw to Keel here. But watch James Harrell. He's the linebacker. This ball was not even close to Keel, and it hits Harrell, and it must have surprised him.
Well, we have Tim King and Bruce Vaughn back to accept a punt from Larry Swider. He's only punted once tonight. Only the second punt of the ball game, and that first punt went for 38 yards. That's strange for a team that's trailing by 21 points, but
they had good field position. Remember, they kept getting the ball in Tampa Bay territory.
Swider now taking a long count, hoping to draw Tampa Bay offsides because they only need 3 yards for the first down.
And
the
timeout.
The Bandits have called a timeout with 6:19 left in the football game. Tampa Bay leads it by 3 touchdowns, 31-10. 6:19 remaining in this game, which looks like it's going to go the Tampa Bay Bandits' way. Next Saturday night on ESPN, more USFL action live from Legion Field in Birmingham. Paul McGuire and Jim Simpson will be on hand for the Oakland Invaders and the Birmingham Stallions. And right now, Paul, that's shaping up to be a great game. I'm looking unhappy, Lindy and Fonte on the sidelines.
He is. He's got a good football team, and he knows it, and they're making some mistakes, that mental errors, and you can't afford to do that in this game.
So Larry Swider back to punt after that Tampa Bay Bandit timeout. It's a high spiraling punt. King is going to let it bounce. It takes a Tampa Bay bounce, and it's down by the Bulls at the Bandit 43 or 44-yard line. So John Reaves and company will have excellent field position, if indeed John Reaves is the quarterback here.
Isn't it amazing? When things go bad, it goes bad. Here's Swider. He had a 38-yard punt, and that one there wasn't much better. And the number one punter in the USFL.
Well, John Reaves stays in the ballgame. I thought maybe Jimmy Jordan might get some work. That was only a 30-yard punt by Larry Swider, Paul, and he's averaging only 34 yards a kick after coming in as the number one rated punter in the United States Football League. So the clock continues to roll. Under 6 minutes to play. First and 10 Bandits at their own 43, and they're leading by 31-10.
And I don't think they're going to stop doing what got them to 31 either, and that's throwing the football. Maybe not on this play, but
in motion is Bronski to make that Fitzpatrick in motion. The give is to Ricky Williams, and Williams pounds his way up to midfield or close to it, in around 5.5 yards in that play.
And on that play, it's up to the back. Now, the play is supposed to be run to the left, Tom. And what happens is here comes Jimmy Jordan in now. But that play is supposed to be run to the left, but the back, it's his option. If he sees that hole to cut back into it, that's what he does. He picked up 6 yards.
Well, Reaves leaves, and Jimmy Jordan, the third-year performer out of Florida State, former draft pick of the New England Patriots of the NFL, is now the home of the Tampa Bay Bandits here in the USFL. Hands off to his former teammate at FSU, Ricky Williams. And Williams spin and is close to having the first down.
He's going to be about a yard short.
Tom Dinkle and Terry Beeson, two former NFLers themselves, making the tackle.
And also Holman, Holman is back in the backfield as the fullback.
Well, the folks in Jacksonville have a chance to see their Bulls again next Friday night on ESPN as they take on San Antonio. Tampa Bay Bandits will be off until a week from Monday when they host the Denver Gold, also here on ESPN. That's income tax day. Just what? Thought you'd like to know that.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
April 15th. One of my favorite days this year. Third and one at the 47. Pitch out to Williams. Williams has the first down and a lot more down to the 40, down to the 39-yard line. For Vaughn Johnson, who's been a busy man in the second half, makes the stop. Gary Anderson, 54 yards rushing call, but that does not, by a long shot, tell this whole story to me.
How about this? That tells you the story. That's over your 100 yards.
137 yards total offense, and again, the Bandits are going to win. You think he may be as good a back as there is in football?
I think so. He does it all so well because he's got great hands. He's an excellent blocker, and we know he can run with it.
That's for sure. Former All-American out of Arkansas. Running with the football now is Walter Holman. Holman, a rookie out of West Virginia State, is brought down by Tom Dinkle back at the 40-yard line.
Walter Holman looked at too many Gary Anderson movies and thought, the way I got the speed, I'd get outside. That's wrong.
Uh-huh. Loss of one. It'll be second down and 11. Holman is 5'10", built along the lines of Greg Boone. He's 5'10", 208. Steve Carter in at wide receiver now, replacing Fitzpatrick. Trout center there. Carter, number 11. He'll be split down to the lower part of your screen. Larry Bronski at the top. 3-10 and counting.
This is throwing down. Maybe a screen. No, toss, reverse.
Toss to Williams, back to Carter. He's got some speed, but he is hauled down, and we're going to have a penalty flag to boot. What speed is shown by Mansell Carter, reserve defensive end out of Notre Dame, as he drags down Steve Carter?
Yeah, but you're right. There's also a clip back there, too. And, you know, I don't know if you take that, do you?
Illegal use of hands, number 65 on the offense.
Now, Reggie Smith, right tackle, 6'4", 285-pounder, called for the illegal block.
That's a refuse.
Yep. Penalty declined by the Bandits. John Reaves on the night, just short of 300.
See if they know that. Now, that's when you give them a couple more plays, let them get to 300, because that is the magic number.
Yeah, but you know, the type of guy that John Reaves is, I really don't honestly think he cares. I mean, a lot of athletes say this. I don't think he cares how many yards he has.
They really don't. They don't do stats. The only stat they want to see is at 31 up there and at 10 against the other team.
They're down at 18 for the Bandits on the Jacksonville 47, and Jordan back to throw. Dump pass to Williams. Got some blocking. The blocking is shut down, and so is Williams at the 45-yard line. Vaughn Johnson again making the tackle. Been a busy night for the former North Carolina State performer. Number 33 there.
Linebackers, this is the one thing that, you know, that they must get in a position to do when they see a screen come up. The linebackers have to position themselves in order to make the play, because first of all, they know they have to take on the blocker, and then they have to make the tackle.
Zenon Anderson getting set to punt on 4th and 16, but he'll have to do so after the 2-minute warning. 2 minutes to go in this football game, and you're not looking at a happy man. That's Lindy Infante, the coach of Jacksonville. It's 31 to Portland is the Breakers, big underdogs to Oakland, lead the Invaders 17-14 in the third.
Don't try to figure this league out, folks.
I'll tell you, 1st and 10 for Jacksonville, backed up in their own 2-yard line. That's where Zenon Anderson's punt was down, and the give is to Larry Mason. And Mason fighting for yardage. To his credit, he hasn't stopped running in this game. He's up to the 10, and we're going to tack on some more. A flag is thrown. Freddie Norgren and Alonzo Johnson. Make that Johnson and Dwayne Anderson on the tackle. 1:41 left to go in this football game.
Oh, another face mask.
Number 52
Mason, they're coming
on the
out. Well, you know, this is what Tampa Bay would like him to do. It doesn't make any difference to them, but we're going to see the face mask is where? I know he almost took his head off, but there's the face mask. Is it on Office?
Yep, Tony Office. Well, you know, Portland went into that game with Oakland without Marcus Dupree. He's been out since the first game with Buford Jordan. If he did play, he had a bad hamstring. I'm not sure whether he played or not. He wasn't listed to play. And Dick Corey has him winning in the third period. Luther back to throw. As his man, the tight end is Keel, but he is horse-collared, I mean that in every sense of the word, by Alonzo Johnson.
Alonzo Johnson is the meanest player out there tonight. I mean, this is like the fourth hit after you catch the ball. He's going to make you pay. If you catch the ball, Mr. Keel, I'm going to let you know that when you do, I'm going to take part of your head. That, that could have been called.
That's legal, isn't it?
I don't think so.
Second down and six at the 19. Luther out to Kemp, and Kemp is nailed by Bruce Vaughn. It looked like a vicious tackle, but it doesn't hurt that much. Ball up the 29-yard line.
How do you know? You're up here.
I've been told that by receivers. They'd rather be hit that way than one of these around the neck.
I'll tell you right now, Alton Alexis is not going to get behind Alvin Bailey on the other side, because Alvin Bailey is anywhere from 15 to 20 yards off of Alexis, and he's not about to let him get deep.
Now 55 seconds to go in this football game now, and of course, as soon as the ball is marked ready for play, well, now we have another problem with the game clock. The official, Wesley Ward, is asking that the clock be reset at 1 minute and 6 seconds. I think I could play coverage the way he's dropping back. Meanwhile, the pass intended for Alton Alexis over his hands and out of bounds, and Alvin Bailey was there.
No, Alvin Bailey was downfield. They set it up beautifully because they had a double coverage with Marcus Quinn, and if the ball would have been thrown on target, Marcus Quinn would have had a touchdown had he caught the ball.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Somebody with a sign there said Georgetown is still number one. They weren't watching the same game I was the other night.
I think they missed something.
Yeah.
It's like that guy sleeping here earlier.
57 seconds left to go. Mike Rozier is now out of the ball game. Larry Mason in there at the setback. Meanwhile, the pass comes over to Alton Alexis. Does some dipsy doodling and gets the first down over the 45 to the 48-yard line, where Kevin McClellan brings him down.
Marcus Quinn was going to kill Alton Alexis. He really was. He went running over there and Alton just did a stop, a little move, and Marcus Quinn ended up on the Jacksonville bench.
First and 10, for the record, at the 47-yard line of Jacksonville. Clock running now, 40 seconds. Paul, you'll be out in Denver on Monday night as Ed Luther hits Larry Mason out of the backfield. Mason inside the 50 to the 47-yard line. You'll be out in Denver where the Gold are 4-2, the Outlaws are 4-2, and we have a timeout called by Jacksonville. In Jacksonville at the Gator Bowl, where some people might be a little bit anxious to see this team perform a little bit better. They'll be taking on the San Antonio Gunslingers Friday night live at 8 Eastern time. And then the Oakland Invaders and Birmingham Stallions, our first look at Bobby Hebert and company, Cliff Stout and his excellent team. That should be a heck of a ball game, Paul, in Legion Field in Birmingham. You'll have it with Jim Simpson.
Oakland's got to get away from Portland before they can think about Birmingham.
That's right. Maybe that's the problem. Well, score by quarter. As you see, Jacksonville got it underway. Tampa Bay a strong second quarter. Very little of any note in the third quarter, but the Bandits, after turnovers, have really shot at this game around a two fourth quarter touchdown. Luther over the middle and intending for Alton Alexis, but it is underthrown, low to the ground, and Alexis cannot hang on, and the clock is stopped with 26 seconds left.
Take a look at that. Well, that's the defensive secondary now. Alvin Bailey, he's just drifting back and back. He's going to get short because he knows that he has a lot of help deep. And they're trying to hit Alton Alexis right in the middle of your screen there. He just drops the football. But you see number 40 back there, Marcus Quinn? That's the man that Alvin Bailey knows he has help from. They're just dropping off into the deep areas. You're not going to get deep on him.
26 seconds, and it's a third and three for the Bulls. To get to the Tampa Bay 43-yard line for the record, and here goes the handoff to Marvin Lewis, and Lewis picks up the first down inside the 35 to the 33-yard line, where he's brought down. 20 seconds. As soon as the ball is marked ready for play, the clock will stop, and that last tackle was made by Sankar Montoot of Tampa Bay.
You know where he's from?
No. Luther going for the touchdown, and he's got it to Perry Kemp. Touchdown, Jacksonville. 34 yards and a score, and that's got to salve the wounds a little bit for Ed Luther.
No, it doesn't.
No?
Not when you lose by 14. But I'll tell you, that was a beautiful pass, and Kemp just stayed with the ball the entire time. He ran right by Bruce Vaughn, and here's the mistake by a corner, and even in this part of the game, because Kemp, number one, is downfield, and Vaughn should never, never in any circumstances let that man get beyond him. But take a look at the over-the-shoulder catch by Perry Kemp. Just beautiful. There was also a face mask on Vaughn.
Well, Ed Luther with a 34-yard touchdown pass to make it 31-16, and Brian Franco is on to attempt the extra point.
Tampa Bay just called a timeout.
Can I ask you a question? Why?
I might not have enough people on the field or they're tired.
take another look at that touchdown again.
All right. I think that what Vaughn was looking for, too, was maybe to get some help from King, number 38, who never does get over into the area to help out. But Vaughn goes back, and there was. He had the face mask of Perry Kemp and burned the ball right in front of the guy. That's nice. That's cute.
You don't care for that, do you?
No.
Well, he won't have to hear about it at least for a few more weeks anyway. These two teams will get together later on in the year in Jacksonville. Swider, the holder, on the extra point. Franco boots it up, and it is through the upright successfully. And so with 10 seconds to go, it's 31-17, the Bandits, and their upcoming games for Tampa Bay. We mentioned it on April 15th, live here on ESPN. The Bandits will be home against the Denver Gold. And then they will be at Birmingham. That should be a great battle indeed. They'll be hosting the Baltimore Stars, who are looking more like the Stars again. Then they'll be out at Los Angeles and back in Jacksonville on May 12th. Not a soft touch in there, and you know something? There really isn't a soft touch. Not one team in this league anymore, Paul, that you can look on your schedule and say, well, that's going to be a win. That ought to be easy.
Well, they're all getting better and better. You know, a lot of people have asked me, and as well, look at this league. They didn't sign all their draft choices. The only thing that tells you, these people are getting better and better and better as they go along. Now, Jacksonville's got San Antonio at Orlando, Birmingham, New Jersey, and Tampa. Now, these are all, out of their five games, they've got four of them at home, which may help them. Here comes the most exciting play in football for me.
What's
the onside kick? Because, I mean, this is where you can really go blast somebody. You know, you run, everybody runs down, and they bunch up. It's good for the kicking team because they can go hit anybody they want. And the offensive team, what they got to do is keep their eye on the ball and not look at the people who are coming after them, so it's not so good for them.
You can see by that graphic that the Tampa Bay Bandits love to be on ESPN. They have won the last nine in a row.
Here it comes.
On ESPN. Here's Franco's kicking. Everybody in Tampa Bay knows that he's going to onside kick it. It is recovered. I believe that's Aubrey Matthews. He fumbles it. And then falling on it for the Bandits was Spencer Jackson, or is that Jerry Price? That's Jerry Price, the tight end. Well, they had it, and then they gave it away again.
I think Aubrey Matthews is getting ready to run with the football, but he didn't pick it up. Now watch. Watch the top guy in the middle of your screen. He's just going to let the ball go over his head because he knows right now it's not 10 yards. Okay, Aubrey Matthews gets the ball, and he's trying to run before he picks up the football, and then Price gets the football, and this game is all over. 8 seconds. This is the old knee job here.
Yeah.
Put your knee down, go home.
If you're a quarterback, what do you say in the huddle? You're Jimmy Jordan, you know you're going to take the snap and fall to your knee. Do you tell joke?
No, you know, I'll tell you, there's nothing joking out there because you got to be prepared. Somebody out there might nail you.
31-17, and now we're one play away from making that the final score of this Saturday night game on ESPN. Well, he's not going to lay down with it. He's going to hand off to Joel Blunk, who's in the game, and Blunk takes the pitch out, picks up a yard or two, and this game is history. John Reaves, Steve Spurrier, and the Tampa Bay Bandits go to meet the Jacksonville Bulls at the middle of the field, shake some hands, and wish them luck down the road.